Welcome, everybody. Welcome to my world.
How is everybody doing?
All right.
Please, guys, as this is the routine, take a moment. Pray. Ask the Holy Spirit to show up in a majestic, glorious way, as only the Holy Spirit can, because he's the eternal, infinite, gloriously majestic, beautiful, sovereign Spirit of the Father and the Son. Father, Son, the Lord Jesus, Holy Spirit, the one true God. So ask the Holy Spirit to show up, to fill me, to fill you, to bless this time, till we go into deep meat as we refute heretics, false prophets, and glorify our God and Savior, Lord Jesus Christ. And as you pray for that, invite folks, announce on your social media pages, which many of you still don't do, even though I'll tell you that we're live. Thank you guys for ignoring me, because that's me. You know, I'm just the squirrel in your world. Yeah, here we go. Come on. 1 second, I'll probably get a guest in. Yep. Kelly Powers. You guys have heard of Kelly Powers? He runs a YouTube channel. He's a Protestant evangelical apologist. He's a Protestant evangelical apologist. He just had a debate a couple of days ago with another vile, wicked, demon-filled son of the devil, son of Satan, Unitarian heretic named Dustin Smith. Sorry about that. On the Gospel Truth, that's a YouTube channel where Marlon, I believe his last name's Wilson. I'm terrible with names, guys. I am very terrible with names. So forgive me if I'm terrible with remembering your names. It's just certain areas, I'm terrible. Geography, I'm terrible. Math, I'm terrible. Names, I'm terrible. So I'm a work in progress. I believe it's Marlon Wilson. He runs a YouTube channel, Gospel Truth. See, I'm trying to remember. See, I'm getting confused. Pray for me, guys. Holy Spirit, fill my mouth, my tongue, the words of my mouth with wisdom, knowledge, and he anoints me to speak without stammering and error for the Lord Jesus Christ. We'll begin in prayer in a minute. But a few days ago, Kelly Powers debated Dustin Smith. Dustin Smith is another son of the devil, wicked, vile, satanic dog who appears as a humble, righteous servant. Don't fall for Satan's schemes. Don't let his sons, his tools, deceive you, because if you believe the Holy Bible, if you believe the Bible is God's perfect word, and it is the voice of the Lord Jesus Christ to the church to guard us by the power of the Holy Spirit from these wolves, right? Because he sends us as lambs in the midst of wolves, Matthew 10:16. Lambs, sheep in the midst of wolves, Matthew 10:16. And then the Lord Jesus says, be wise as snakes, serpents, harmless, innocent as doves. Know how your enemy thinks so you can protect yourself, but do not act like your enemy, because you are servants, slaves of the Holy Spirit, filled with the Holy Spirit, to conduct yourself in accord with the scriptures the Holy Spirit has inspired, which is the voice of the Lord Jesus, our great shepherd, the Son of God. Okay, now, if you go to 2 Corinthians 11, take a moment. I want everyone to go to 2 Corinthians 11, read verses 13 and 15. Okay, 2 Corinthians 11, verses 13 and 15. And invite folks, because we wait at least 10, 20 minutes until the regulars show up. Invite folks, announce on your social media pages, and ask the Holy Spirit to fill us and fill me, to not shame the Lord Jesus Christ, but to bless you, and that the Holy Spirit will give us the spiritual food, the nourishment we need to feast off the holy flesh and drink from the precious blood of the Lamb, the Lord Jesus Christ, which is our spiritual food, our medicine, our healing, our protection, our salvation. Now, in 2 Corinthians 11, 13 and 15, 2 Corinthians 11, 13 and 15, there you will see that Paul, by inspiration of the Holy Spirit, says, Satan appears, masquerades as an angel of light. And then he says, no wonder that he does so, because his servants, his sons, those that he controls and uses to deceive people and destroy them by following another Jesus, embracing a different spirit and believing in a different gospel, they appear as ministers of righteousness. That's what he says. They appear, Satan empowers them to appear as servants of righteousness, apostles of righteousness, humble, spiritual, pious, kind, articulate, but that's a facade. That's Satan's way of covering up the poison that will damn your soul with chocolate. Because again, if I bring you straight up poison, and you know it's poison, you'd be stupid to take it. But if I give you, let's say, a plate of M&Ms or Snickers or Reese's peanut butter cups, you'd rush to eat it because the chocolate, the peanut butter, covers over the poison that's in the center of the Snickers, of the Reese's peanut butter cups, the Twix, whatever it is. So it covers over the poison, which makes you more likely to take and eat, not realizing it's going to damn and kill you, damn your soul, right? You get my point? So Dustin Smith will give the appearance of being professional, articulate, well-dressed, well-mannered, humble, but that's to cover over the fact that he's a filthy, vile, satanic dog, swine from the pit of hell, filled of Satan, his father, and he's a liar and a Bible pervert. May the Lord Jesus Christ use me to expose and shame and muzzle him for the glory of Jehovah Jesus, the eternal Son of the Father, the eternal heart and companion of the Spirit. The reason why I mention that is because I've been receiving some comments from people that Kelly Powers, who's an evangelical Trinitarian apologist, who loves the Lord Jesus Christ, who worships the triune God, who's not too happy with me embracing the apostolic tradition. He made a comment when he found out that William Albrecht and myself will be teaming up if the Lord Jesus wills. If the Lord Jesus wills, I'm still healthy and holy in love with Jesus Christ, which is my hope. The Holy Spirit will fully possess me and own me and seal me to glorify Jesus in my life and even in death to bring Jesus Christ, my Lord, glory and never shame or dishonor him. Lord willing, in February, William Albrecht and myself will be debating two Protestants on the perpetual virginity of Mary. When he saw that, he made a comment where he was shocked, and now he's praying for me to repent. Can you believe that? He wants me to repent of what is an ancient, widespread belief of the early church established by the Lord Jesus Christ. So he wants me to repent of that, so I can follow the later Protestant denial of what was the universal belief of the early church. But anyway, be that as it may. So people were telling me that Kelly didn't do as well, and they were wondering if I would do a review of it. And so I went and listened to one clip that Kelly posted on his YouTube channel, and I was disappointed. I really was. So I sent him a message. I go, do you have a follow-up? Because you dropped the ball here. So he just commented, what do you mean I dropped the ball? So hopefully he'll call me and I can help him. If he's humble enough and teachable enough, I wouldn't mind the Holy Spirit using me to bless this brother for the glory of the Lord Jesus Christ, because it's not about our ego. May this, the Lord Jesus, destroy, crush, obliterate my pride, my arrogance, my ego, my false sense of humility, my false sense of humbleness, my fake piety, and destroy any ounce of envy and jealousy in me. Destroy all that filth, crush, crucify, mortify my filthy flesh, my lusts, and the fruits of my flesh. In Jesus' name, and I pray that for all of us. In Jesus' name, in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, by the power of the holy blood of our God and Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. So I wouldn't mind helping him if he's humble enough to accept my willingness to sharpen him by the power of the Holy Spirit for the Lord Jesus Christ. So we'll see. I told him I'm live. Let him call, because we're going to play that clip. Disappointing. A golden opportunity to pulverize, bury the son of the devil in a gracious manner. Not saying you got to be rude. Be as gracious as you are. But he dropped the ball. And so I'm going to read to you the comment that was sent to me, so you guys don't think I'm making it up. Let me just open up my Skype in case he calls. Right? So bear with me. Now pray that the Lord Jesus will bless the visual audio qualities, that the Lord Jesus will beatify us, beatify me with his holiness and beauty. The light of the Lord Jesus Christ shine in and through us, destroying the darkness in and around us, that we're filled with the Holy Spirit, and that the internet connection will be strong and I won't be a nuisance to my neighbors. We'll begin in prayer in a minute, but let me find the comment real quickly, guys. Let's see if he'll call me. I don't know. If it's not an ego fest and we're brothers in Jesus Christ, sent by the Spirit to sharpen one another, then I don't see any reason why he wouldn't call me, because I'm going to play the clip for you. Here's the clip, and we're going to deal with it. Here's the clip. Let's first, let me get there. He took a clip from the debate when they're doing cross-examination. Here it is, Berean Perspective Apologetics, run by Kelly Powers, and it was posted October 23rd, 2021, Old Testament Challenge. No scripture says God is only one person. Prove me wrong. Unitarianism debunked. He had such a golden opportunity to decimate him, and he dropped the ball. He really did. I'm sorry, Kelly. I love you as my brother in Jesus Christ, our Lord, because you're Trinitarian, even though you're praying for me to repent from what is ancient and universal, widespread belief of the church because of your Protestant tradition. That's okay. We can agree to disagree, but you dropped the ball here. So here's the link. We'll play it after I pray, but let me just show you the comment. And I sent it to him. I sent it to him. Someone sent it to me, and I sent it to him. Let's see. Here. I posted on its comment section. I said, I've been getting comments about your debate. Here's one. Jeremiah H. And I had sent it to him 24 minutes ago. I put in the comment section. Dear Sam, this past week, Kelly Powers and Dustin Smith held a Trinitarian versus Unitarian debate. Now, I guess this brother may, English may not be his first language, a lot of typos. I was skeptical going into it concerning how Kelly would fare. It turns out for good reason too. He just doesn't articulate his points very well. The Unitarian heretics are convinced their guy won. I would encourage you to step up your game and sharpen your ability to articulate your points. If you need help, let me know. That's what I said to him. So after I posted what Jeremiah H. said, I said to him, I'd encourage you to step up your game and sharpen your ability to articulate your points. If you need help, let me know. So you see that? People weren't happy and satisfied with his performance. So we'll see. So we'll play that clip, and then we're going to get into Ahmadinejad. God's timing is amazing. God's sovereign decree in that the way he orchestrates things to fall in place at the perfect time is amazing, because God is real. He is almighty. And the God who is real, who's almighty, who lives, is the God of the Holy Bible, the Father, his Son, the Lord Jesus, and the Holy Spirit. The Bible being the voice of the living God. So thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for revealing yourself perfectly in your perfect word, that you perfectly preserved the Holy Bible, the voice of our great shepherd, the Lord Jesus, to the church. Empower us, Abba, Father, to be enslaved to your voice, the voice of your Son, the voice of the Spirit in Scripture, to obey your voice, to love your voice, to be empowered and transformed by your voice, to proclaim your voice boldly, without shame, without compromise, and by your voice empowering us, may we die glorifying your voice and never betraying you, Father, never denying the Lord Jesus, never blaspheming the Holy Spirit. Guard our mouths, put a guard on our mouths, that the Holy Spirit will take over our tongues, our words, perfectly and completely, and take over our lives perfectly and completely, and all we own we give to the Holy Spirit. Everything from our ministries to our bank accounts to our money, everything we give to the Holy Spirit. And by the Holy Spirit, please do not allow us to ever betray, deny, disown, blaspheme the Lord Jesus Christ to save our lives or for the praise of men. May we glorify the Lord Jesus Christ, even if they behead us, kill us, beat us, please, by your Holy Spirit, because we cannot do it. So we trust in the Holy Spirit to give us that power, as he did to many holy martyrs, that if we must, we will die for Jesus Christ, because he is worthy. Give us the power to die to our flesh, to despise our flesh, to crucify our flesh, destroy our lusts, our sinful passions, our pride, our arrogance, our ego. Please, Abba Father. Please, Lord Jesus. Please, Holy Spirit. Strengthen my voice. Make it powerful and pleasing and passionate in blessing your church and being used by your Spirit to strengthen your church and to glorify the Lord Jesus Christ. And Abba, Father, I ask that you fill my throat with the breath of life, perfect health, and fill my lungs and my chest and my arteries and heart with the breath of life, with health, and grant us the grace to maintain our health, to get healthy, and that I keep getting healthy by the power of the Holy Spirit giving us perfect self-discipline, self-control, so that our health will not be used against us, Abba, Father. Save us from lust, from gluttony, from whatever it is that hinders us from loving you perfectly, obeying Jesus Christ perfectly, from being filled with the Holy Spirit completely. Save us from Satan, from his children, from their blasphemies. Muzzle them. Teach them the fear of the Lord and make us warriors and lions and lionesses, willing to be killed for Jesus, imprisoned for Jesus, and beaten for Jesus, and never betray the word of the Lord Jesus Christ. And save us that we never fall into any scandal, whether sexual or financial, that we will never whore ourselves, spiritually whoring ourselves for fame or money. And I ask, Abba Father, that you do the same for our loved ones, my daughters, my angels, that you'll wash them, wash our loved ones, wash us in the blood of the Lamb, the Lord Jesus, and fill them and fill us with the Holy Spirit of life. And bless this session, Abba. Bless the sound, the audio, and the visual qualities, and your internet connection. And please take over my tongue so I don't get anyone confused, that I don't speak in error. Save me from error, from stammering, from confusion, to recall the scriptures and interpret them perfectly, and give us the power then to obey those scriptures perfectly, not to be hearers and hypocrites, but doers of your word. I beg you, Father, for that grace. And give us your peace, your joy, your calmness. Flood us in your love, your joy, your peace, and your calmness to focus and to be still and know you are God. You are God, Abba. The Lord Jesus, your Son, is God. The Holy Spirit, your eternal Spirit, the Spirit of your Son, is God. The one God who is you, the Father, in union with your Son and in union with your Spirit. We thank you, Father. We thank you, Lord Jesus. We thank you, Holy Spirit. Be with us in Jesus' name. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, bring them in droves for your glory and grant me the gift of contentment. In Jesus' name, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory, both now and forever, into ages of ages. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Yahovah Rapha, Yahovah Rapha, Yahovah Rapha. Heal us by the blood of the Lamb, the Lord Jesus Christ. Yeah. Okay, guys. I guess Kelly Powers is not going to take me up on it, but that's okay. We'll deal with it. I know Adam Seeker is here, right? Is he here? Adam, you here? Guys, keep praying for me that I can truly love Jesus and obey Jesus Christ and worship the Lord Jesus Christ and not be a hypocrite and disqualify myself, and ask the Lord that the discipline is given me, he will strengthen me in that discipline to keep the weight off and get healthy so my health will not be used against me by Satan. Okay, Adam, I'm going to call you so you can explain what happened with Uthman, that fat, satanic slob, stone-licking pagan, Ibn Fibin Farooq. So I'm going to call you right now, all right? You can explain, because it's in Urdu. Sadly, most of the world doesn't speak Urdu, but you guys think you're special, you own the world. So unless you get someone to play subtitles, there's not much that this session will do for those who don't speak Urdu. What's going on?
God bless you.
Okay. You guys, you already know Adam Seeker. God is using him mightily and majestically for the glory of Jesus Christ by the power of the Holy Spirit. His Urdu channel gets over 400, 500 people. There are Muslims who are hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ getting saved. who don't speak English. So pray for this man, his family. The Lord Jesus will keep him safe for many years. Provide for him and his family, and that he'll be a light glorifying Jesus Christ, and he won't stumble. So what happened today? Explain what happened today.
Yesterday, when Uthman ibn Farooq went to Texas in one of the mosques, one of another friend of mine, who I do not want to expose his name right now, but his channel name is Sach Bol TV. He is from Pakistan as well. He and another friend of mine, we went there, live recorded it.
They went there? They went there?
Yeah, they went there.
Okay.
Right, stood right outside the mosque, held a 6 foot long banner, which when a 5-6 foot long guy is holding, it's like a 12 feet long banner. Khair Ragale means welcome in his language, Ibn Farooq's language. We sent another guy inside the mosque, asked Ibn Farooq to come out and have a talk with us.
When you say us, it sounds like you were there.
No, brother. I wasn't there.
Can you do me a favor, brother? I want to say I love you, brother. Just breathe a little bit.
English.
Breathe. Logo, just calm down. I love you. You're excited. Calm down. Don't rush. And I know you think you're speaking Urdu. And Urdu, you can say us, meaning that they represent you, though you're not physically there. I want you to now change your thinking. I'm not speaking to Pakistanis who, when I say us, they understand I mean my friends who represent me, though I wasn't there. So don't confuse us, because that's how you confused me in the beginning when he said, we went to Texas. I go, what? So why don't you try this again? They were there.
All right.
They challenged him. He came out to talk to them. I know it's all about you and you want people to think you are one of the eight archangels.
No,
you're
brother,
one of the eight archangels that came down from heaven. There's only seven archangels, not eight. But go ahead.
Sorry, brother. Yeah, so yeah, yesterday was a blessing because Abbas Agha came to my channel now. So there's so many things which happened yesterday. Praise Lord. Anyhow, so Ibn Farooq, he came out. He saw these people. Now I'm going to use the these word. And then he came and had a talk about the Quran's perfect preservation. We are going to upload, not we. Okay, we because I'm going to upload the video. Working on the video to hide the number plates. What do you call it in America? The number plates. Car tags, I think, if I'm not mistaken. Tags of different cars which were present there. And once it's done, we are going to upload that. And you are going to see how he ran away in just 5 minutes. How easy it was. And he ran away saying, I need to go to a lunch. We asked him to write just one verse of the Quran as it is perfectly preserved by his Allah.
And that was it? He left?
Oh, no. We had like a little bit of a discussion and all. And then he started running and not we. They started following him and all.
You see how humble he is? It's we, because he wants to be the man, take attention. It's not you. You suck, dude.
Yeah, I suck. Yeah.
Okay. So they. All right.
They.
So they kept talking to him, and it lasted how long, the conversation?
It was like a 15-minute conversation at max, and he ran away, and that was the end of it. The thing is, people say that he is a good debater.
No, he's terrible. He sucks. He's a fat slop. He's worse than his dog, Muhammad. And watch what I'll do to him. If the Lord Jesus wills, people are wondering, I'm going to go, Lord willing, when God confirms the time. And I'll have people recording. But you guys are just going to have to wait, because he's not important. He's scum. He's an idiot. He's one of the stupidest debaters you'll ever meet. He's a joke. But the Muhammadans, who are demonized, demon-filled like him, they don't care how bad and stupid a person is. As long as he just opens his mouth and barks, that's good enough for them. But anyway, go ahead, brother.
So basically, there are certain conversations in the conversation, which is in Urdu, and translations are being added into the stream. I am currently doing some editing on it as well to mix 3 videos that we made at that particular time. And we'll upload it in multiple channels at the same time and push it, because his challenge was in the last stream, show me one verse in Quran which is not the same as of Muhammad. And we asked him to just write. We gave him a piece of paper and a pen. Hey, write this verse. And he was not able to. And multiple pieces of different books, chapters, or printout or made a printout to show him that you are written is wrong. But you know what? He doesn't even memorize the Quran, brother, because he went into his phone to see what that verse says. So he's not even a hafiz, brother. That's the beautiful part of it. He's not even a hafiz.
No, brother, you're incorrect. He is a half-wit.
Okay, half-wit.
No, you kept saying he's not a half-wit. He's actually a half-wit and then even less half-wit. But anyway, so you're going to be able to upload it and put subtitles in English for people to understand?
Yes, half of the conversation is in English. Some part is in Urdu. Those parts are being translated as subtitles.
Good.
So you will see all of that.
So you have them give me permission. I'll upload it to my channel as well because he's a joke anyway.
Oh, yes. You can upload it and you can push it to anyone who wants to download it and upload it. Be my guest. This is free for all. Just upload.
You're a good man. I don't care what they say about you, Adam, especially Hussein. I don't care what that ugly monster says about you.
Amen. Praise the Lord, brother. Okay, thank you so very much.
Let us know when it's uploaded and so that I can then upload it and then I won't have to waste my time and call you anymore, just block you. But I'm just using you for now. I'm not going to block you until I get that video and then I'm going to block you, okay?
All right, brother. And sorry about the confusion of TV.
TK. All right, man. Love you, man.
All right, brother.
God bless you. Is there anything else you want to say? Because I know you can't leave without getting some more attention. Any final words?
Yeshua Akbarul Azim.
Takbir.
Al-Masihu Akbar.
You got it, brother. Lord bless you. Take care. All right. So you guys heard it, right? You heard that Adam wasn't there, but he took all the credit for it. You see it? He's not there, but he kept saying we and us because it's his world and we're all squirrels and it's all about him. Like I said, Uthman is a joke. The fact that people take him seriously, that tells you that Muhammad is a joke and Muhammad's God Allah is a joke and the Quran is a joke. And I want to apologize to scum, filth, toilet paper, piss, urine, crap, you name it, dogs, because they're all offended when I liken Muhammad and Allah of the Quran and the Quran to them. So I have to apologize to them on the Day of Judgment. So with that said, again, we've prayed, but ask the Spirit to fill us. Help me to help you guys. Do not get into side talks or side debates with anyone. Focus on the topic. Please help me to help you. You don't need me. You don't need to be here, but you're here because you're trusting the Lord Jesus Christ will use imperfect vessels by his perfect Holy Spirit to feed you, nourish you, and strengthen you and sharpen you to love Jesus Christ more and live for him more passionately. And that's what I'm hoping as well for the glory of Jesus Christ. So, Istata, your prophet is an ad hominem and I piss on him. Don't act tough or intelligent in the comment section. Call me on Skype because I'm going to use the Quran to wipe your arse with and show your Quran is one big ad hominem against Jews and Christians and pagans, you filthy slime dog. I'm going to block you if you don't call me like Jesus blocked your prophet, that bastard in hell. Again, I apologize to bastards. I apologize to filth and swine. My apologies. I know you're better and cleaner than Muhammad. So stop barking like your prophet did when he mounted a minor and violated her. Your prophet is scum. He's a whore. Again, I apologize, scum, and I ask you whores to forgive me, especially the whores of Jannah, where perverts like this scum will have eternal erections to deflower you, which is never going to happen, only in Muhammad's Miraj. But anyway, stop barking. Be more man than Aisha. Skype me, Istata, so I can send you to Mecca to lick the black stone like a pagan. Anyway, guys, invite folks. Lord Jesus, take over the session. Lord Jesus, take over my mouth. Do not let me shame you and do not let me be politically correct or a crowd pleaser. We love you, Son of God. We love you, Lord Jesus. In Jesus' name. Okay, I think we have a Mohammedan dog. Hold on. Let's see if he really is. Let's see. Okay, we got some scum. Let's see. I'm going to call him here and see. Because, you know, these bastards come and they talk about Muhammad beating women and they think I'm Muhammad. So let's see. See, now the dog won't pick up because I'm on the phone. You there, dog? Hey, stupid. You know, that's all you can do? Are you barking like your prophet did? Okay. I know he's a dumb spiritual whore, son of the devil. Okay. There you go. That's it. Okay. That's it. See? I know I was wasting my time with his dog. Sorry about that. Okay, that's it. I knew it. They're all going to pick up to mock. Anyway, are we ready now? Guys, the demons are manifesting. Muhammad's dogs are manifesting because we're about to destroy Muhammad. Like Jesus has already buried him in hell, and we're going to add to his misery for the glory of Jesus Christ. So muzzle the dogs. Are we ready now? Are we ready? Let's deal with this clip from Kelly Powers. Here it is. Kelly Powers. Guys, you guys know me by now. I'm not interested in being politically correct. I'm not interested in appeasing people in order to get them to support me. You guys know that by now, right? I'm not interested. I don't care because let me be quite upfront. I have seen the fruit of this approach, this sissified, effeminate form of Christianity. And I see my brothers and sisters, Lord Jesus Christ, being eaten alive and buried. And Kelly Powers is an example. And I hope he's hearing this because he's too nice. I'm not saying be a jerk. Don't be like me. I mean, I'm a jerk. May God save me. And I pray I never shame the Lord Jesus or grieve the Holy Spirit. But you got to be a little more bold and passionate. And you got to be a little more quick. And you got to be a little more dominating, right? A little more forceful. Like, believe it or not, like James White. When James White debates certain people, he's very forceful. The only time he becomes sissified, effeminate, is when he's dealing with certain Muslims because he wants to appease them to keep a door open so he can be relevant and do more debates with them. Like Anthony Rogers. Look at him. He's perfect blend. He's not overbearing, but he's not an effeminate, sissified speaker. He is bold, he is confident and witty, and he destroys you in a very nice manner, right? Jay Smith is also passionate when he debates. He's dominating, right? This is how you got to be, man, honestly. Matt Slick, perfect when it comes to anti-Trinitarians. So I've seen the fruit of this effeminate, sissified Christianity, and it doesn't work. It hasn't worked, and it will not work, and don't deceive yourself. You're not honoring the Lord Jesus Christ. You're not. You're not honoring the Lord Jesus Christ. Don't think being an effeminate sissy where you get the Unitarian heretics pulverize you and get away with lies and murder is honoring to Jesus Christ. It's not. You're not. I'm being honest. Dinah, good to see you, sister. I pray your husband's doing well by the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, right? Anyway, let's go through this. Let's watch this clip. And I guess Kelly Powers thought he did a good job. I'm sorry, brother. You dropped the ball. And if you were to call me, I would show you why you dropped the ball. Okay? I would show you why you dropped the ball. Hopefully, you'll be humble enough to do so for your own sake. It's about the glory of Jesus Christ. It's not about ego or envy and jealousy and about our ministry. It's about the Lord Jesus Christ. And I'd be more than happy to help you become all you can be if the Spirit is pleased to use me, because it's from the Spirit that we can be all we can be for the glory of Jesus Christ. But that's you. It's your loss if you don't, honestly. Here's the link. Let's go through this. Are we ready? Let's go through this. And disappointing because he could have just pulverized him. He would have annihilated him. But here goes. And it's Kelly Powers who uploaded this clip. So I guess he thinks he did well. Okay. The Lord have mercy on all of us. I love this song. Here's the clip.
Okay. If God has been revealed in the Old Testament as not just being singular personage, which still I haven't found yet, let me ask that question to you. Here's the hard question. Can you point to me one reference, just one, where any scripture, Old Testament, exclusively says God is one personage?
So notice what he's saying. He keeps saying personage. I don't know why. That sounds more like Mormon jargon terminology. Can you show me in the Bible where God is one personage, meaning person? I know that Mormons in their writings talk about personages. Typically, Trinitarians use the term person, persons. But again, that's splitting hairs. But you get the point, right? He, for some reason, says personage. And that's more akin to Mormon language. And maybe it's because he interacts with Mormons, and that's why. So notice the challenge. Can you show me a single verse in the Bible? Can you show me a single verse in the Bible where it says God is one personage? Personage. Okay? Where the Bible says God is one personage. And take a moment to ask the Spirit to fill us and ask the Lord to bring more people. Invite more folks. Come on, guys. Get on your social media page. Okay, now let's see the answer.
Yes, and it's Deuteronomy 6:4 in the Greek version, where I mentioned, and since the Greek version is still technically the Old Testament, that falls under our purview here, to where the Greek cardinal number Es is used, which refers to...
If you go to his clip, he then puts on the screen, I pray that I will learn how to use Skype and YouTube to the fullest for the glory of Jesus Christ, where I can then upload images and words. Because he says, Greek Septuagint does not say one person. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. Deuteronomy 6:4, Greek Septuagint. So he posts it. The problem is he didn't address his objection. Here's the objection. The Greek translation of Deuteronomy 6:4 says that God is Es. Now that's the way you'll find many non-Greek speakers pronouncing the Greek New Testament, right? Typically, the way you'll find those who are not Greek, who don't speak Greek, whose mother tongue is not Greek, when they pronounce the Greek words found in the New Testament or in the translation of the Old Testament into Greek, they pronounce it in accord with what's typically referred to as the Erasmian pronunciation. So he says Es, but you're going to hear people like Daniel Wallace or even James White saying Heis, Heis. But this particular group, these Unitarian heretics, these sons of the devil are filled with their father, the devil, because Dustin Smith is part of that same group of heretics, sons of the devil like Carlos Xavier and Anthony Buzzard. They prefer to pronounce the Greek more akin with the way modern Greek speakers pronounce these words. So a modern Greek speaker doesn't say Heis Kurios, one Lord. They would say Es Kyrios. So they're trying to pronounce the Greek New Testament or the Greek Old Testament the way a modern Greek speaker would pronounce these words if he or she were to read the text. Are you with me there? So Es is the word for one. Now, those who are taught Greek in Bible college or seminary, they still follow typically the Erasmian way of pronouncing. So listen to me, guys, by the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ. I want to help you because I'm learning with you. The Holy Spirit's teaching me as he's teaching you, right? So if you go to, let's say, a Bible college or a seminary, whether Catholic or Protestant, they don't pronounce it Es. They pronounce it Heis. They don't say Kyrios. They say Kurios. Heis Kurios. So keep in mind, the word Es is the same word that someone like Daniel Wallace, who wrote a grammar on advanced Greek grammar beyond the basics. Daniel Wallace is considered one of the world's leading evangelical scholars of the Greek New Testament. He wrote a grammar called Greek Grammar Beyond the Basics, which is the standard Greek grammar used in Bible colleges and seminaries to teach students the Greek grammar of the New Testament. That is his specialty. He is a scholar in that area. Okay? Are you everyone with me there? Are you learning? Because we're going to go into meet. Now, I don't want to be boring, but I'm not here to entertain you necessarily. I want to be used the Holy Spirit to educate you, know your faith more perfectly, and live it out in love of Jesus. Okay? The grammar book that Daniel Wallace wrote is called Greek Grammar Beyond the Basics, because he is a bona fide scholar of the Greek New Testament. And that is the grammar used in Bible colleges and seminaries. Now, Daniel Wallace pronounces it in accord with the Erasmian way. He wouldn't say Es, he would say Heis. Now, these heretics, Carlos Xavier, his father Anthony Buzzard, and Dustin Smith, these sons of the devil, filled with their father the devil. May the Lord Jesus shame and muzzle these dogs and use me and others to do so. They like to pronounce the words the way a modern Greek speaker would. Keep that in mind, okay? Es is how a Greek speaker looking at the word would say it. Heis is the Erasmian way. Okay, now let's listen to his argument.
One that is grammatically masculine, meaning one person. The Lord is one. So that's
how to say one person? The Greek.
Well, the cardinal number one that's masculine refers to one person.
So in Deuteronomy 6:4, you're saying, I just want to get there here. 6:4, you're saying that it says that God is one person?
Yes, the cardinal number Is is masculine. So it refers to one person.
All right, so just to give a heads up, I'm showing you. I have the Greek Septuagint right in front of my face right here. And this is what it says, unless you got a different version. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. It doesn't say one person.
Drop the
There's
ball.
No person there.
Is that a question you're asking me?
Well, I'm just following up with what you said. So do you have
I know I don't think that's the correct translation there. If the Lord is
so
one.
You think that Brenton, who is a recognized scholar there, who translates this, is not translating that accurately?
I'm fully capable of translating the Greek, but I'm also well aware of.
So which Greek word is the word for person there? Which word is it that I'm missing?
Is, he kept saying.
So how come they didn't put that in here in any English translations that I read online?
Terrible argument. Sorry.
Because I think there's not an English translation of the Septuagint.
I'm just saying I've read the Greek Septuagint online. I mean, you would think that would be important for that to be somewhere, don't you think?
So, and he's laughing, the guy. The guy laughed, Dustin Smith. This son of the devil, may the Lord Jesus deliver him into my hands so I can silence him. And William Albrecht told me, he's challenged this guy to debate. And he said he wouldn't debate William because he's too harsh and polemical. You see, these cowards, these dogs, they will butcher the scripture. They will blaspheme the Lord Jesus Christ, rob him of his glory because they're convinced he's just a man. And they will go about it in a nice manner so they can be more appealing. So they look very professional. If you see him, he looks very professional, very handsome, wearing a suit, because that's how Satan appears, professional, and he appears as an angel of light, right? And yet, when they know there are people who don't fall prey for their schemes and their lies and their tactics, they'll avoid them like the plague because they know they'll get destroyed and their satanic God will be destroyed by the true God, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, by Jehovah Jesus Almighty. But then what they do is to make an excuse for their cowardice. Well, you're too mean and polemical. Well, that means you just condemn Paul. You condemn the apostles. You condemn Prophet Elijah and the early church fathers, because they didn't tolerate filthy, wicked, Satan-filled, blasphemous dogs like you. And they put you in your place, like St. Nicholas did to Arius. Okay? But I am sorry to say, Kelly, you dropped the ball, brother. And may the Lord Jesus grant me grace not to be proudful, may destroy my pride and arrogance. But did you see the argument that Kelly offered? Well, my translation doesn't say Is is one person. And he's a reputable scholar. And how come no English translation says it? Ignoring what he said about the word itself. Now, let me repeat the argument. Well, let's hear it one more time. It's a short clip. Hebrew or Greek, Deuteronomy 6:4 does not state one person. Go check out the full debate. Okay, let's hear it one more time, because now I want to show you. Now, remember, he claims to know Greek. This is why you're going to be disgusted with these Unitarian sons of the devil. He said he knows Greek. If he knows Greek, then he knows he just lied through his filthy, wicked mouth. And I'm going to prove it to you from the Greek. I'm going to prove it to you. Thank the Lord Jesus that because he's the Almighty God, one with the Father and the Spirit, he raises up his servants, filling them with wisdom from the Spirit to expose these liars and destroy their blasphemies. Because watch how he's going to get humiliated. Okay, but let's hear it one more time, guys. This is for you guys. I'm doing it for you guys to be used of the Holy Spirit to guard my brothers and sisters in the Lord Jesus Christ from these wolves who pretend to be servants of God. Listen. It's like Muhammad, that bastard whore.
Okay.
Muhammad, son of Abdullah, the son of Dog, son of Muta, the prophet of Satan. See, we destroy Muhammad, that bastard, and we piss on him so he can protect you Christians from Muhammad, lest his jihadis come and rape your women, whore women, and molest your young children, because that's what Muhammad, that bastard whore, that son of the devil's burning in hell did. May the Lord Jesus save you and Muslims from him. See, we're doing the same thing with Muhammad.
If God has been revealed in the Old Testament as not just being singular personage, which still I haven't found yet, let me ask that question to you. Here's the hard question. Can you point to me one reference, just one, where any scripture, Old Testament, exclusively says God is one personage.
Yes, and it's Deuteronomy 6:4 in the Greek version, where I mention, and since the Greek version is still technically the Old Testament that falls under our purview here, to where the Greek cardinal number es is used, which refers to one that is grammatically masculine, meaning one person. The Lord is.
Look at Tukeli's response.
So that's
how to say one person. The Greek.
Well, the cardinal number one that's masculine refers to one person.
So in Deuteronomy 6:4, you're saying, I just want to get there here. 6:4, you're saying that it says that God is one person?
Yes, the cardinal number es is masculine, so it refers to one person.
All right, so just to give a heads up, I'm showing you. I have the Greek Septuagint right in front of my face right here. And this is what it says, unless you got a different version. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. It doesn't say one person. There's no person there.
Is that a question you're asking me?
Well, I'm just following up with what you said.
Watch the demon smirk, the satanic smirk.
Well, I know I don't think that's the correct translation there. If the Lord is one.
You think that Brenton, who is a recognized scholar who translates this, is not translating that accurately?
I'm fully capable of translating the Greek.
See what he just said? Now I'm going to bury him. He just said, I'm fully capable of translating the Greek. I'm fully capable of translating the Greek. Okay, watch. Now how we're going to bury this guy. Because that means he knows he's lying. He's a blasphemous dog, son of the devil. Watch.
But I'm also well aware of...
So which Greek word is the word for person there? Which word is it that I'm missing?
Okay. Yeah, you see how embarrassing that is? The man told you several times, Kelly, my brother, please. Es is masculine singular. And you're asking which Greek word?
In any English translations that I read online.
Because I don't think there's not an English translation of the Septuagint.
Yeah, I'm just saying I've read the Greek Septuagint online. I mean, you would think that would be important for that to be somewhere, don't you think?
And he's laughing. And the guy's laughing at Kelly. Brother, may the Lord grace you to learn and perfect you for his glory. You dropped the ball. It was embarrassing. This is why I see people are complaining about the debate. And yet you're coming off as being confident of your argument when he actually schooled you there. But glory to Jesus Christ, your mistakes can be used by the Lord to then teach us. Now, Full Armor Apologetics gave you the answer. Full Armor Apologetics already knew the answer. You see, he mentioned in the comment section. Notice what Full Armor Apologetics says. So Galatians 3:28 also says we are all es in Christ, similar to Echad. Now, see? You see what the response was? Let me show you. Remember, according to this son of the devil, es or heis, masculine singular means one man. And he says, I'm fully capable of translating the Greek. I hope, Dustin Smith, they bring this to your attention because you are a vile, wicked son of the devil for butchering scripture to deceive people to worship your satanic God. Because you don't worship God. You think you worship God, but it's a satanic deception. May you repent, or may the Lord Jesus muzzle you by raising up his servants to expose you like he's doing now for the glory of Jesus in Jesus' name. I have no respect for you demons trying to damn people's soul to hell. See, this is why I'm serious. This is not about winning arguments. It's about damning people to hell. If you follow this pervert, the son of the devil, you have another Jesus, a different spirit, a different gospel, and that can't save you. He's damning you to hell. It's serious, guys. That's why you can't just take it lightly and just chum up with them and buddy, buddy. See, the early church fathers knew that. The early church fathers knew this is your everlasting soul that's in jeopardy. They knew it. They knew if we tolerate heretics and their lies, we are now jeopardizing the salvation of the flock so that if they follow another Jesus, embrace a different spirit, or affirm a different gospel, they will be cut off with everlasting destruction. See, they knew it's serious. It's not a joke. But today's evangelical, or today, not just evangelical, but today's Christians in the West, It's to them, it's a joke. It's like, it's okay. This guy's preaching another Jesus. It's all right. Let's be buddies and chum up. Dude, this guy, if he's wrong, he's now going to mislead people to follow a false god to hell. And you want to be buddy-buddy with him? Serious? Why do you think I like Matt Slick when he debates the anti-Trinitarians? You know what he says? Go listen to his debates. Look, it's not personal. I'm not attacking you. But I believe you preach a false gospel and you have a false god and you're going to hell and you'll be destroyed until you repent and accept the true Lord Jesus Christ. Man, right on, Matt. That's how you got to address them. Okay, let me give you Galatians 3:28. Now, he said, I'm fully capable of translating the Greek, okay? So he's without excuse. By your words, you shall be condemned, and by your words, you shall be acquitted. Right? So his own words testify he's a son of the devil. Like his father, the devil, he butchers scripture. Here is the interlinear for Galatians 3:28. You don't need to know Greek to see the Greek words because they're transliterated. Galatians 3:28. Here it is, guys. Click on it. BibleHub.com provides an interlinear of the Hebrew and Greek Bible. You don't even need to read Hebrew. It transliterates it for you. Take a moment to click on it and invite more folks because I want more people to learn that the Spirit will use me for the glory of Jesus to protect the flock. Not that he needs me, but he's pleased to use me. Amen. Okay, click on it. Notice Paul is talking about all those who have turned to Jesus Christ and have been baptized into him. If you have turned to the Lord Jesus and you've been baptized in water, which is the means by which the Holy Spirit will be given to you to make you spiritually alive and make you one with the Lord Jesus Christ, where now Jesus's redemption is applied to you and you're now part of his spiritual body. Notice what Paul, by inspiration of the Holy Spirit, says about you, all of you. Look what he says. And I'm just going to read the literal translation of the Greek here. Neither there is Jew nor Greek. Uk eni udaius, right? I don't need to agree, but anyway. Neither there is slave nor free. Neither there is male and female. Why? All, pontes, all of you, not just one man, not one person, all of you, multitudes of human beings, multitudes of believers who are born of the Spirit, united in the Lord Jesus Christ, all of you, as many as you are, all for you, one, ace, esti, in Cristo Jesu. Here Paul uses ace, masculine singular, you can pronounce it heis, to refer to multiple human beings, males and females, who are all united as eis, heis, one in the Lord Jesus Christ. You got it? That's how you refute him. That's how you expose this demon, the son of the devil. You see it? You got it? Remember his argument when he said, show me where it says God is one personage. He said ace. He said the word heist means he's one person. You see what kind of liar he is? You see what kind of liar he is? Does that mean we Christians are one person? Because Paul used the word ace, heist, to refer to all true believers who number in the millions as being east, heis, in our Lord Jesus Christ. Because we're one body, right? One man in Christ. So you see again what he did? Then he said, I'm fully capable of translating the Greek. That means he has no excuse, right? So how do you respect these people? Convince me to respect him. How do you respect such an individual who knows he's lying? So no, east does not prove God is one person. You are a liar like your father, the devil. Is must be defined by the context. Okay, everyone there? Do we see the refutation to his argument? Do you see the refutation of his argument? So now if Kelly had used this argument, he would have embarrassed him, but he dropped the ball. Okay? He dropped the ball. Sorry, Kelly, you dropped the ball. You had an opportunity to have obliterated him, but you dropped the ball by saying, well, Brenton, he's a scholar, and he trans this way. That doesn't help your case, brother. So now let me give you another example. Okay? Another example where the word "is" is used for two distinct human persons, human beings, a male and a female. Okay, are you ready for the other example? Here it is. Ephesians 5:31. Paul, by inspiration of the Holy Spirit, citing Genesis 2:24, and our Lord Jesus himself cites that same passage. You'll find it in Matthew 19. Write down Matthew 19, verses 4 to 6, specifically 5 and 6. Verses 5 to 6 of Matthew 19, and also found in Mark 10. Now, here it is, guys. Here's the link. Please, when I give you a link, click on it to verify. BibleHub.com, Ephesians 5:31. Paul quotes Genesis 2:24, which says, "For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and cling to his wife, so the two become one flesh." Now, in Hebrew, it says basar, basra, my language, basar, flesh, echad. Now, here, when Paul quotes it, let's read it. There it is. Little translation from the Greek. "Because of this, will leave a man, anthropos, his father and mother, and be joined to the wife of him, gonaika autu, kai or kai, and will be the two, duo, into sarka mian." You see that word, mian? It's the feminine adjectival form of is. It's is. It's the same word, but it's the feminine adjectival form of is. This is is. Now, here Paul is using the feminine form of is, heis, to refer to a male human and a female human becoming one. Is. It's, guys, don't let the word mian confuse you. Mian is the accusative feminine adjectival form of is. It's the word is. It's the word heis. It's the same word. Anyone knows Greek will confirm it, and the lexicon will confirm it. So here's how you're going to confirm it. When you click on it, you see the word mian? Click on that word. It's going to take you to this page. It's going to show you where this word mian is used throughout the Greek New Testament. Okay? Okay. Then, when you look to the right of your screen, it says Concordance Entries, Strong's Greek 1520. For those who don't know Greek, you click on it, and guess what shows up? The word heis. Here it is. The word heis, is. Mian is simply the feminine adjectival form of is. Feminine accusative form of is. It's the same word. And yet here it's used for one human male and one human female becoming one. Now, he said he's fully capable of translating the Greek, right? So do you think that he knows this? Well, if he's claiming to know Greek, that means he knows this. Well, if he knows this, then he knows these arguments, doesn't he? So why did he lie? Why did he lie? Can you explain that to me? Does he not care for people's souls? And supposedly, he worships the God of the Bible. But the God of the Bible hates lies, hates deceit, hates trickery. And the God of the Bible is truth and loves truth. So if he was truly a servant of the God of the Bible, why is he lying? Why is he deceiving? Why is he perverting the Bible, knowing that people's everlasting souls are at stake? And you wonder why I hate these people and dislike these people and have no respect for these people? Because, guys, you can be wrong when it comes to math, science, or any other field of knowledge and still be safe from an eternal perspective. But if you're wrong about the Bible, you're wrong about who the God of the Bible is, and if you're wrong about who Jesus is, that's your everlasting soul that will perish. It's not a joke. Guys, it's not. It's the most serious issue. Is that clear? So we got that. So now we can move on to Ahmed Didat and Muhammad in the Bible. This is why I was saying glory to the triune God. His sovereign timing is amazing. I wanted to respond to Muhammad in the Bible yesterday, but my response to Taylor Stewart took too long. So I had to defer it today. And now watch how God's timing is perfect. Glory to the Lord Jesus Christ. Unbeknownst to me, I ended up discovering a short 10-minute clip, less than 10 minutes, where Ahmed Didat is addressing the very prophecy that I wanted to respond to yesterday. Muhammad as the Paracletes. Had I responded to it yesterday, then I would have missed the opportunity of killing two birds with one stone, destroying this claim that Muhammad is the Paraclete of John and destroying Muhammad's dog, Ahmed Didat, for the glory of the Lord Jesus Christ. So you see God's timing. And by the way, don't forget, isn't there a debate going on? Is Chris Claus debating, guess who, Taylor Stewart? What time will that debate take place? Does anyone know? Our brother in the Lord Jesus Christ, Chris Claus, is debating Taylor Stewart today on his YouTube channel. I believe it's scheduled, if I am correct, 4 p.m. my time. Let's double check. Because if the debate starts in an hour, then I'm going to conclude, because I want you guys to go and support your brother, Chris Claus, who loves and worships the Lord Jesus Christ, who's a Trinitarian, as he silences Taylor Stewart, another demonized tool of the devil and a Bible pervert. Let's see. Here it is. Let me get you the link. Oh, yeah, we got time. Glory to Jesus Christ. Guys, we got time. It is scheduled 2 hours from now. In 2 hours from now, here it is, the link. Chris Claus, our brother in the Lord Jesus Christ, is debating Taylor Stewart 2 hours from now. Here's the link. Guys, make sure you go and support our brother. Make sure when we're done here, pray for Chris. Go there and support. Subscribe to the channel. These are the soldiers and the lions that we need to be praying for and supporting, because they are putting themselves on the line. They're doing their part to advance the kingdom for the glory of the Lord Jesus Christ, and we need to support them. So there you go. Here's the link 2 hours from now. So with that said, let's expose Ahmed Didat. Kill two birds with one stone for the glory of Jesus Christ. Let me get you the clip. By the way, go to the description box. I put the links to Didat's statements and the rebuttals to Didat and the rebuttal to the claim that Muhammad is the Paraclete of John 14, 15, and 16 in the description box. So by the grace of Lord Jesus Christ, let's go through this clip and dismantle Ahmed Didat. You're going to see why the Lord, in his righteous anger, struck Ahmed Didat down like the dog that he was, left him in a vegetative state, making him an invalid from 1996 to 2005 to teach Muslims the fear of the Lord Jesus Christ, that you will not get away from blaspheming Jesus. Muhammad is dead and buried. Jesus is alive. And if you mock the Lord, you will fall into his hands. And when he rises to discipline you, he will teach you his fear that you will not get away with mocking the Lord Jesus Christ. Here it is. Because you're going to see why I'm saying this. Here it is. Here's the clip. Ask a Muslim. Jesus prophecies about Muhammad. 9 minutes, 54 seconds, February 9, 2021. Here it is. God's timing, I found this. Here it is. Let's play it.
He says, I have yet many things to say unto you, but ye cannot bear them now. Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth. For he shall not speak from himself, but what things shall he hear, that shall he speak, and he shall declare unto you the things that are to come. He shall glorify me. 8 masculine pronouns in one verse. I say, it ill befits a ghost.
You understand his argument? Guys, help me to help you. Ask the Spirit to help you to focus. Don't get distracted, please, because you want to learn your faith to live it out and affirm it and defend it for the glory of Jesus Christ. Notice the first argument. In John 16, speaking of the Paraclete, the one to come, the Lord Jesus applies 8 masculine pronouns to him, 8 times. It's one masculine pronoun applied 8 times. He. And he goes, that does not befit a ghost. If this is referring to the Spirit, you don't speak of a spirit as an he. The pronoun he is used of the Spirit 8 times, showing he's not a ghost, a spirit, but a man. That's his argument. Keep this in mind. Please keep this in mind. So let's continue.
You agree.
You agree.
Man, 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 man.
Listen. Here goes the clip.
Holy Quran says, وَإِذَا قَالَ عِيسَى بْنُ مَرْيَمَ says, behold, Jesus, the son of Mary, said, يَا بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ O children of Israel, إِنِّي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ إِلَيْكُمْ So most certainly, I am the messenger of God sent to you all. مُصَدِّقًا لِمَا بَيْنَ يَدَيَّ مِنَ التَّوْرَاةِ Confirming the revelation which came before me. وَمُصَدِّقًا لِمَا بَيْنَ يَدَيَّ مِنَ التَّوْرَاةِ وَمُبَشِّرًا بِرَسُولِي يَأْتِي مِنْ بَعْدِ اسْمُهُ أَحْمَدِ And giving you
Now pay attention to his argument because he's so stupid, like his prophet who's burning in hell, thank the Lord Jesus. He's going to end up contradicting himself and burying himself. Pay attention to his argument. Listen, this is why we really need the Holy Spirit. And I keep hammering this. Ask the Holy Spirit to help you understand perfectly. Because if you don't listen with understanding, you're going to miss so much. Watch how he's going to bury himself. Because again, like Muhammad, he was an idiot who was made stupid by the demons that possess his prophet.
Bad tidings of a messenger to come after me, whose name shall be Ahmad, which is another name for Muhammad. Muhammad and Ahmad are synonymous terms.
So he claims.
The Quran tells us.
Quran tells us.
But Christian says, look, it's not in my book.
In my book.
It's not here. There's no Ahmad and there's no Muhammad. So you are left with no alternative but to analyze what is there. You see, they have verses in the Bible, in the Gospel of St. John, chapter 16, where it says, Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. Jesus said, it is expedient for you that I go away. For if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you. But if I go, I will send him. And when he is come, he will convict the world in respect of sin and of righteousness and of judgment. Of sin, because they believe not in me, and on. He says, if I don't go, the Comforter will not come to you. We say that Comforter is Muhammad.
Listen to this.
He says, no, Jesus didn't say Muhammad. He said Comforter. We are asking, did Jesus speak English?
Okay.
Did he say Comforter?
Listen.
He says, no, he spoke Hebrew. That's his mother tongue. Then he said, what did he say? You haven't got it. In other languages, in the Arabic language, nearest to Hebrew, he used the word Muazzin.
Now, did you see what he just said? Pay attention. He said, in the Arabic language closest to Hebrew, when they translated the Gospel of John into Arabic, the word they used for parakletos, Rasmian way, wherever, was Muazzi. Okay? Notice what he just said. I want you to pay attention. Why do you think I say, please, help me to help you? And I sound like a broken record, and I'm sure you're disgusted with me. But I'm going to sound like a broken record because this is a class setting. And I want you to know and understand to the fullest so you can be used mightily by the Spirit for the glory of Jesus Christ. Please ask the Spirit to help you focus and understand. Please. Because that's the work of the Holy Spirit. I can't do it for you. I can't do it for myself. He just told you, did Jesus speak English? No. Comfort is an English word. Well, in Arabic, closest to Hebrew, when they translated what John wrote in Arabic, the word parakletos, parakleton, the accusative, parakletos, the nominative, was translated in Arabic as muazzi. Do you guys hear what he said? The Arabic translation of John translated comforter as muazzi. Everyone got that? Let me know you got it. Okay? Let me know you got it. Because now watch how he just buried himself. If you're paying attention, this was his funeral service. This is why, sadly for me, I wasn't around when this guy was alive. I promise you, by the power of the Holy Spirit, I would have humiliated him to the point that he would try to get me killed. Because he told Josh McDowell, true story. Josh McDowell has confirmed this. Josh McDowell, you'll find his debate with Ahmadidat online. Josh McDowell, with the assistance of John Gilchrist, South African Christian apologist, and a retired lawyer, debated Ahmadidat on the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's online, a glorious debate where McDowell pulverized, steamrolled, destroyed Didat. And it's online thanks to YouTube. Go watch it. Josh McDowell, Ahmad Didat. Didat was so badly defeated. You know what he told Josh McDowell after the debate? And then thanks be to our sister, Light for the Nations. She posted the interview between Didat and Rashid where he did the same thing to... Not, I'm sorry. She posted the debate, not the debate. Lord Jesus, save me from stammering. Holy Spirit, rebuke Satan, loosen my tongue. Please, Holy Spirit, in the name of our God and Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, rebuke the evil one in Jesus' name who's trying to attack us. Sorry about that. Satan will do anything to distract us, even attack our speech. Shield our mouths from the evil one, Holy Spirit. Light for the Nations, and I uploaded it to my YouTube channel, took a clip of the late Anish Roach being interviewed by Rashid, where he mentioned, and they played the clips, Didat sent a hit squad to try to murder him. So Didat was infamous and notorious for trying to get people murdered whom he couldn't defeat in debate. He tried it with Shirosh, but the Lord Jesus protected his life. We got the clips where Shirosh recounted the attack in South Africa and how the Lord protected him. It's on our YouTube channel when he was interviewed by Rashid. After the debate, you know what Didat said to Josh McDowell, guys? You know what Didat said to Josh McDowell after the debate because he got so badly defeated by McDowell? He goes, if you come back here, I will kill you. He threatened to have him murdered. He goes, if you come back to South Africa, I will kill you. Said it to McDowell, and McDowell has confirmed it. He threatened to murder him if he came back to South Africa. And you know this filthy dog, whom the Lord Jesus struck down like a dog and left him an invalid vegetable from 1996 to 2005, would do it? Because he sent his men, a hit squad, when Anish Roach came to South Africa to debate him, and Didat never showed up, and they attacked him and tried to murder him. Okay? So, Josh McDowell versus Ahmad Didat. Now, that said, pay attention to what he said here, guys. He said that the Arabic translation of the Gospel of John translates the Greek word parakletos as muazzi. Please pay attention. I want to see how many of you are going to catch it. Let's see how many of you are going to catch it.
I said, did you speak Arabic?
Did he? Okay, did you hear it? Did you hear it? One more time.
Hebrew. He used the word muazzi.
Muazzi.
I said, did you speak Arabic? He says, no. I said, what did he say? In Afrikaans, the word there is truasta. I said, did you speak Afrikaans? He says, no. What did he say? In Zulu, umthokozi. I said, did you speak Zulu? Your Jesus? He says, no. I said, what did he say?
He blasphemed Jesus, right? He goes, your Jesus? You see the demonic hate and filth and blasphemy from this scum? Your Jesus, and watch how he insults the Holy Spirit. When you see that, you're going to see why the Holy Spirit struck this dog down like a vegetable, an invalid, 1996 to 2005. Google it and YouTube it. Where for 10 years, like an invalid vegetable, Jesus shut his filthy, wicked mouth, left him a vegetable where he couldn't speak, he couldn't move, all he could do is, that's it. You filthy dog, you got what you deserve. The Lord Jesus taught you his fear. Thank you, Lord Jesus, Son of God.
In 2,000 different languages, you can buy the Bible today. 2,000. And in 2,000 different languages, there are 2,000 different names. What did he say?
Did he say?
Did he say muasi? Did he say comforter? Did he say truester? Did he say togazisi? What did he say? The Quran says he said Ahmad, okay, which is another name for Muhammad. But since you have lost the term, it is in the Arabic language.
Okay, you hear what he said? The Quran says he said Ahmed, which is another name for Muhammad, which is a lie. He can't prove that. But I don't know if you caught it. See, this is why I say pay attention. I'm going to replay that one moment, what that part again. Listen.
He spoke Hebrew. This is another time. Then he said, what did he say? You haven't got it. In other languages, in the Arabic language, nearest to Hebrew.
In the Arabic language, nearest to Hebrew, the Arabic translation of the Gospel of John says what? Listen, please. I want to see who caught it. May the Holy Spirit illuminate you to pay attention so you can be used for the glory of Jesus to demolish blasphemers. Let's see if you caught it.
He used the word blasphemy. I said, did you speak Arabic? He says, no. I said, what did he say? In Afrikaans, the word there is truaster. I said, did you speak Afrikaans? He says, no. What did he say?
Okay. He just said Jesus didn't speak Arabic, right? Jesus didn't speak Arabic. However, the Quran has Jesus speaking Arabic. In 61:6, the Quran has this counterfeit Jesus Isa speaking Arabic and using an Arabic name, Ahmed. You see how he just buried himself? Did you catch how he just humiliated himself? How the Lord Jesus just made him look stupid and buried him with his own words? Did you catch it? Muwazzi, did he speak Arabic? No. But wait, you son of the devil. Your Quran has Jesus speaking Arabic. But you just admit Jesus didn't speak Arabic. So why does your Quran have Jesus speaking Arabic? And wait, you son of the devil. Ahmed is an Arabic word. Hello? See why I said you got to pay attention? You see why I get on your case, guys, out of my love for you? I'm very tough and forceful with you because we're not paying attention the way we should. Satan is destroying our attention span, dumbing us down because we live in a time, because of all this technology, we have lost the ability to focus and pay attention. We need to rediscover it. You got it? And may the Lord Jesus perfect these abilities in us, these gifts in us, these gifts in me for his glory. You caught it? Why I said pay attention? He said, remember, he said, did Jesus speak Arabic? And he answered, no. But wait, you stupid son of the devil. Your Quran, chapter 61, verse 6, is quoting Isa, whom you believe is Jesus, in Arabic. So your Isa is speaking Arabic, and Ahmed is an Arabic word, but you just admit he doesn't speak Arabic. Got it? What did Jesus say in the Bible? Do not add to his words, because he will expose you as a liar. Proverbs 30, verses 5 to 6. Okay, let's continue. So then what's his argument?
In Zulu, I said, did you speak Zulu? You're Jesus? He says, no. I said, what did he say? In 2,000 different languages, you can buy the Bible today. 2,000. And in 2,000 different languages, there are 2,000 different names. What did he say? Did he say Muassi? Did he say Comforter? Did he say Truester? Did he say Togazisi? What did he say? The Quran says he said Ahmad, which is another name for Muhammad. But since you have lost the term, the name is lost. No sense in me pushing it down the throat. He said, look, it was Ahmad, another name for Muhammad.
Yeah, but that's Arabic. Now what we have to wait, you dumb satanic.
We have to deduce.
Dumb satanic demon. That's Arabic. Ahmad Muhammad is Arabic. That's not Hebrew. That's not Aramaic. Show me the word Ahmad in Hebrew. Show me the word Muhammad in Hebrew. In fact, doesn't Ahmad and doesn't Muhammad come from the root Hamid, which means praise? But in Hebrew, the word praise is Hallel, like Hallelujah. So it doesn't even correspond to Hebrew, you dumb satanic dog. Uh-oh. Someone made a boo-boo.
Reason with them.
Reason with them. Well, yes, please reason with me, please.
You say it is the Comforter. Who is the Comforter? I said, the Comforter is the Holy Ghost.
Look at the blasphemy.
The Comforter is the Holy Ghost.
Listen to his blasphemy of the Holy Spirit.
So they'll ask you, is Muhammad a ghost?
Is Muhammad a ghost?
He says, no. So it can't be Muhammad. Jesus makes it a condition that if I don't go, he won't come. But if I go, I will send him. So if it is the Holy Ghost, we are suggesting that, look, the Holy Ghost was long before Jesus was with the people. According to your Bible, in the Gospel of St. Luke, chapter 1,
listen to the blasphemy.
We are told that Elizabeth had the Holy Ghost. What it means, I don't know.
But did you catch the insult? She had the Holy Ghost. What it means, I do not know. He's indirectly, implicitly trying to blaspheme the Holy Spirit by suggesting something dirty is taking place. This is what a filthy dog he was. What it means, I don't know. Now watch this.
But she had it.
But she had it. You heard?
Before Jesus was born. What it means, I don't know. But she had it. Before Jesus was born.
Did you catch the tone? Do you see how he's trying to blaspheme the Holy Spirit? But watch, remember, what did Jesus our Lord say? Because guys, this is going to give you more proof. The Bible is supernatural. The God of the Bible is real. Our Jesus is alive. Muhammad is dead, and he's a dog buried in hell. And that Jesus will humiliate blasphemers and silence them and shame them. Watch how I'm going to now turn it against this filthy dog who's already dead. I hope he got right with Jesus. If not, he's burning in hell with his prophet. Okay, watch. Watch another insult. Wait. It gets worse, this dog.
The Holy Ghost was there. It tells us again that Zechariah had the Holy Ghost. What that means, I don't know. It also says that John the Baptist, Yahya alayhi salam, they call him John. Yahya. We say Yahya. He had the Holy Ghost from his mother's womb before he was born. The Holy Ghost was with him in his mother's womb inside.
See that?
What he was doing inside there, I don't know.
What he's doing inside there, I don't know. You see the blasphemy? What was he doing inside there? I don't know. You see the blasphemy?
But it was there. Look, this is what the Bible says.
Now, let me explain his argument. Now, let me turn it against him. Okay? Let me explain his argument. The argument goes like this. Pay attention now because we're going to go into super in-depth spiritual meat. You're going to learn more about the Trinity from John chapter 14, 15, and 16. You're going to learn more about the role the Holy Spirit plays in salvation. And you're going to learn more about learning context and how to read contextually so you don't be deceived and duped by sons of the devil. And you're going to learn more about how to prove Muhammad is a son of the devil, a dog of the devil burning in hell under the feet of the Lord Jesus Christ, if you pay attention. But now let me explain what his argument is. Please help me to help you guys. I'm here for you. You don't need me. But if you're here, that means you want to learn. So do not let the demons distract you. Okay. His argument goes like this. The Comforter, the Paraclete, cannot be the Holy Spirit. Okay? Cannot be the Holy Spirit. Why? Because in these examples that he gave you, in Luke chapter 1, verse 15, we are told that John the Baptist would be filled with the Holy Spirit in his mother's womb. In Luke 1, 41, we are told that Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit right around the time the Blessed Mother conceived the Lord Jesus Christ in her blessed consecrated womb. We are told that Mary conceived by the Holy Spirit. And then we're told in Luke 1:67, we are told in Luke 1:67 that Zechariah, he too was filled with the Holy Spirit when John was born and his mouth was open and he prophesied. Not only that, if you go to Luke 2:25-35, Luke 2:25-35, we're told Simeon also was empowered by the Spirit, guided by the Spirit, instructed by the Spirit, and in tune with the Holy Spirit. So what's the argument? In John 16:7, listen to the argument because we're going to demolish it in a minute. In John 16:7, the Lord Jesus says, unless I go, the Comforter will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. So what's the argument? Whoever the Comforter is, he wasn't there. But the Holy Spirit was there. If the Holy Spirit was there, he can't be the Comforter because the Comforter wasn't there and he would only come after Jesus leaves. So understand the argument. The Holy Spirit was there with Jesus. The Comforter wasn't there at that time. He'll only be there after Jesus leaves. Therefore, the Holy Spirit can't be the Comforter. You understand the argument? If you understand the argument, we're going to bulldoze this liar and show Muslims how John 14, 15, 16 proves that Jesus is Muhammad's God and destroyer. Okay. Now let me turn his blasphemy against him. Remember, people living in glass houses shouldn't throw stones because your glass house will come crashing down on Allah of the Quran and Muhammad, who's burning in hell. He blasphemed the Holy Spirit But let me show you what his filthy book of trash, his book of porn, the Quran says about Allah's spirit. Those who speak Arabic are going to confirm this. You Arabic speakers who read and write Arabic, please confirm to the non-Arabic speakers and readers here what I'm about to say. Chapter 21, verse 91, literal Arabic, 21:91. And she, supposedly Mary, the mother of Christ, but don't worry, the medium of the Quran is a satanic counterfeit. Isa is a satanic counterfeit. This is not the real Jesus and not the real mother. But anyway, 21:91, Surah An-Anbiya, 21:91. And she who was chaste, no, that's not what it says. And she who guarded her vulva, her vagina, ahsanat farjaha, farj. The Arabic word farj means private part. When used of a woman, it means her vulva, her vagina. Literally, the Quran says, and she who guarded her vulva, vagina, we breathe into her our spirit. 21:91. Now let me get you 66:12. 66:12. Surah Al-Tahrim, 66 verse 12. And Mary, the daughter of Imran, bint Imran, who guarded her vagina vulva. Ahsanat farjaha, farj. Now here's where it gets really filthy and pornographic. And we breathed into her vagina vulva. Fihi, into it, into the farj. We breathe our spirit into her vagina vulva. That's what the Arabic literally says. That's what the Arabic trash of the Quran literally says. You caught it? The literal Arabic Quran says that Allah blew his spirit into the vagina vulva of Maryam. Literal Arabic. Literal Arabic, I'm not lying. Let me get you my article on this. Guys, don't let the Muslims lie to you. I'm now going to give you my article that I wrote on how filthy, pornographic, wickedly disgusting this description is. So Muhammad's glass house came crashing down on Didat, this dog of Muhammad. You're lucky, Didat, you're dead. Well, I mean, you're not lucky, because now if you haven't repented, you're burning in hell with your prophet by the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, Muhammad's God and destroyer. Here it is. But I'm saying if you're around, I would have humiliated you. Here you go, guys. Here's the article. This is the article I wrote showing how filthy and wicked pornographic the language is. And I even quote Muslim scholars admitting it here. Let me give you one citation. Mahmoud M. Ayoub, a modern Muslim scholar. In the book, Christian-Muslim Encounters, edited by Yvonne Yesbek Haddad and Wadi Z. Haddad, page 67. Look what he says. I quote, the language of this verse, Luke 1:35, is clearly circumspect when it says Holy Spirit will come upon Mary. It implies no sexual union or divine generation of any kind. Furthermore, while Luke's description agrees both in form and spirit with the Quranic idea of the conception of Christ, now notice what the Muslim admits. This is his words. Okay, it's in my article. I'll give you the link again. Look what he says. Okay. The language of the Quran is far more graphic and open to interpretation. Now again, same book, same author, he goes on to say this. Let me read his translation of the Quranic verses and his commentary. Then of Mary, he continues. This is him. I'm quoting the Muslim in this book. She who guarded well, literally fortified her chastity. Now he puts literally generative organ, literally her generative organ, the organ by which she gets pregnant. And thus we breathe into her of our spirit, and we made her and her son a sign or miracle, ayah, for all beings. Now notice what he says. Quote, in the second instance, the Quran speaks of Mary as a righteous woman who lived in strict chastity and obedience to God. and Mary, daughter of Imran, who guarded, well, her generative organ. That's his translation, guys, right? Farjaha. And thus we breathe into her of our spirit. The bold and graphic statement appears to have shocked traditionists and commentators, so that most of them tried to cover it up with different and far-fetched significations, or glossed over it without comment, ignored it. Ibn Kathir interprets the phrase, guarded well her generative organ, to mean safeguarded and protected it. Guarding well, ihsan, signifies chastity and high birth. He comments on the phrase, and thus we breathe into it of our spirit, thus. That is, through the angel Gabriel. So Gabriel blew into it. This is because God sent him to her, and he took for her the form of a man of good stature. God commanded him to breathe into the breast of her Khamis. His breath went down and penetrated her generative organ and thus caused her to conceive Jesus. Now, finally, from him, page 68, this is him now. This is the Muslim, Mahmoud M. Ayub, Abu Jafar al-Tusi, the juris doctor of the Shia community, as well as his well-known disciple al-Tabarsi, read the words, we breathe into it literally. Al-Tusi says it has been held that Gabriel breathed into Mary's generative organ, then God created Christ in it. So did you catch it? Ibn Kathir and the Shia said it was Gabriel who blew into Mary's vagina vulva. So now notice how disgusting this is. They believe Gabriel is the spirit that appeared as a man. So Mary had a man stand before her and then blow into her vagina vulva. And this wicked satanic dog would dare mock the Bible and blaspheme the Holy Spirit of the Bible. Now you understand why the Lord struck this dog down, left him in a vegetative invalid state from 1996 to 2005. Go see how horrid his condition was. Go to YouTube, put Ahmadinejad, final days. So Muslims realize Jesus is real, Muhammad is dead, and if you mock him, he will disgrace and humiliate you to teach you the fear of the Lord Jesus Christ. Go watch him. This is him. From 1996 to 2005. See, now Christ could have made it easy and just struck him dead and sent him straight to hell, but no. He allowed him to suffer like a dog as a sign for others. It is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. That's all he could do. And weak his eye. That's it. Couldn't move his hands. Couldn't move his feet. Couldn't speak. God took everything that he used to blaspheme the Holy Spirit away from him and left him like a vegetable for 10 years. That's a lesson to you Muslims. Jesus is alive, Muhammad is dead, and he will humiliate you because he is God and will not be mocked. Okay? So now let's continue a little further so then I can begin the rebuttal. Are you with me? Are you guys okay? I'm not torturing you, right? This is not boring to you, right? This is blessing you, strengthening you, and encouraging you. We piss on your prophet Muhammad, that whore, Tosiq, like the Shia pissed on your mother when they did muta with that whore, on your prophet. If you're a man, you wouldn't go around beheading people and raping women. You'd call me on Skype and defend your dog, Muhammad, who's burning in hell with Didat if Didat didn't repent. Glory to Jesus Christ. Okay, let's continue. I'll let him continue his rant, and we're going to refute him. And I promise you, you're going to get a lot of meat on the Trinity, the deity of Christ, on the role the Holy Spirit plays in teaching the church, sanctifying the church, saving, preserving the church, and how this section of Scripture proves that Muhammad is the slave of Jesus and Jesus is his God.
Jesus, when he was preaching and healing, he said, I, by the Spirit of God, do these things. I, by the finger of God.
Listen to him. He's right.
Spirit of God is that Holy Ghost. Did the Holy Ghost help him in his ministry? He said, yes. Help him to perform miracles? He said, yes. Did the Holy Ghost help his disciples? Yes, when they went out on the mission of preaching and healing, with whose help were they preaching and healing, if not with the help of the Holy Ghost? So the Holy Ghost was with Elizabeth, was with Zechariah, with John the Baptist from his mother's womb, was with Jesus, was with the disciples. So it makes no sense to say that if I don't go, he won't come. Condition. But if I go, I will send him. It's something other than the Holy Ghost. And it's just simple, basic. Now, how can Muhammad, we can say that this one? Let's see. The same chapter, verse 7, it says, I have yet many things to say unto you, but he cannot bear them now. How be it? When he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth. For he shall not speak from himself. For what things shall he hear, that shall he speak, and he shall declare unto you the things that are to come. He shall glorify me. Eight masculine pronouns in one verse. I say, it ill befits a ghost. You agree?
Now you see how...
Amen, amen, amen. Eight times there is not another...
Okay. You see how ridiculously stupid that argument is if you know your Bible. The Holy Spirit, because he's spirit, cannot be described with masculine pronouns he. Now, either this guy is more illiterate than Muhammad or he knows he's lying, because according to the Holy Bible, God is spirit, John 4, 23 to 24. God is spirit. The Father is spirit. And yet all throughout the New Testament, God the Father is referred to as he, him, his. For example, John 3, 16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. Whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. So according to this idiot's logic, because God is spirit, you cannot refer to him as a he. And yet, that's exactly what we find, because the pronouns show that he's a personal spirit. What does that mean, personal? It means that God the Father is not simply an impersonal force, an active force like in Hinduism, New Age thought, or Buddhism. God the Father is a personal spirit, meaning he's spirit who is a person. Likewise, the Holy Spirit, the reason why the Bible will ascribe masculine pronouns to the Spirit is to affirm that the Holy Spirit is personal, a personal spirit. He's not an active force. He's not impersonal, but a living, dynamic, conscious person. That's all it proves. Moreover, since he doesn't believe that Allah is a man, all throughout the Quran ascribes to Allah, in Arabic, masculine pronouns. Therefore, according to his logic, Allah is a man. You see how stupid this guy is? Do you see how to rebut this, right? You guys know how to rebut this, right? The reason why the Holy Spirit could be identified with masculine pronouns is to affirm that he's personal, a living, dynamic, conscious person, and not simply an active force, a power. Just like God the Father is spirit, but God the Father is described as a he, a him, and a his, not because he's a man, but because he's a personal spirit. Similarly, the Holy Spirit is a personal spirit, not simply an energy, which is why masculine pronouns can be attributed to him. Is that clear? And if he's consistent, that means all of the Quran is a man, because personal pronouns, masculine pronouns, are ascribed to Allah. He, masculine, so Allah is a man. So is that clear? So I can move on to the rest of it? Did that make sense? So I can move on to the rest of it? Because I want to get to the meaty part. Okay, let's move on. Listen now, because he's almost done.
Another verse in the whole Bible with eight masculine pronouns or eight feminine gender or eight neuter genders. There isn't. This is a unique verse for a unique personality, Muhammad. But we are told he's a spirit.
Yeah.
Is Muhammad a spirit? I say yes.
Muhammad's a spirit. Let's pause here. I'll destroy his butchering of 1 John chapter 4 a little later. Now, note, guys, I may have to do a part 2, Lord willing, or I may be able to finish it today. Hopefully, we'll finish in one session. I'll be done with Muhammad in the Bible. Note the 6-minute, 41-second mark in case I'm not able to finish it. Let's deal with the claim that the Comforter cannot be the Holy Spirit. It must be Muhammad. Let's argue and agree, yes. Now, do not like the King James Version. So we're going to read the Authorized King James Version, all right? So we're going to agree with D-Dot, the Comforter is Muhammad. God forbid such blasphemy. Let's just agree with him, right? Okay, watch what's going to happen here. You guys already know this. This proves Muhammad was a deatheist. I'm trying to look for the word. What the word means, not Trinitarian. He was a deatheist. I got to come up with a good word. But anyway, forget about it. Forget the word, okay? Let's just go with him. Let's just go. But hey, it's Muhammad. It's Muhammad. All right. Okay, we're going to use the King James Version because that's what he preferred. He loved the Authorized King James Version. That was his preferred Bible. So let's use the Authorized King James Version. Let's crown him. D-Dot, let's crown him. All right. He went to John 16:7. Guys, get ready to see the decimation. God has made the destruction of Islam so easy, it's almost laughable that there are people who still believe in Muhammad. John 16:7. Here goes. Let's read. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth, it is expedient for you that I go away. For if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you. See, the Holy Spirit was there. Comforter wasn't there. Therefore, Comforter is not the Holy Spirit. Okay, I agree. But if I depart, I will send them unto you. Dum diddy dum dum dum. Did you forget the fact that the same verse says Jesus sends the Comforter? So did Jesus send your Muhammad? So you're telling me, yeah, binitarian, exactly. You're telling me, D-Dot, that in the 7th century, Jesus from heaven raised up Muhammad and inspired Muhammad and sent Muhammad to preach the gospel. Nice. Oh, but hold on, D-Dot. Hold on, D-Dot. King James Bible, baby. John 15:26. But when the Comforter is come, whom I will send unto you from the Father, I will send unto you from the Father, even the Spirit of truth, which proceedeth from the Father, he shall testify of me. Hold on, D-Dot. Not only does Jesus send the Comforter, but the Comforter comes out of the Father. He proceeds out of the Father from heaven. So are you telling me Muhammad is a pre-existent spirit that was there in heaven with Jesus and the Father and came out of the Father from heaven because Jesus sent him from the Father into the world? Interesting, D-Dot. Oh, but wait, we're not done yet. Hold on, D-Dot, hold on. John 14:26, but the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, so we're even told it's the Holy Ghost, Holy Spirit, end of story, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance whatsoever I've said unto you. So hold on, D-Dot. The Father and Jesus together send the Comforter, who's the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of truth, out of the Father in heaven into the world in the name of Jesus. And what will he do? Not only teach the disciples all things, but in John 16:14, Jesus says of that Comforter, he shall glorify me, for he shall receive of mine and shall show it unto you. So the Comforter will be sent by the Father and Jesus together, who will be sent out of the Father, who comes out of the Father from heaven, in the name of Jesus to glorify Jesus. But Muhammad was sent by Allah in the name of Allah to glorify Allah. Muhammad was sent by Allah in the name of Allah to glorify Allah. Well, if the Comforter is Muhammad and Jesus sends the Comforter along with the Father from the Father himself into the world in the name of Jesus to glorify Jesus, that means Jesus is Allah the God of Muhammad. Because when Muhammad came in the name of Allah, that's the name of Jesus. When Muhammad glorified Allah, he was glorifying Jesus. Because the Comforter glorifies Jesus and comes in the name of Jesus by the authority of Jesus. Oh, we got a Unitarian dog here. Good. My man, you here?
Yep, I'm here.
Good, man. Finally, we won't have you acting tough in the comment section. We can discuss your heresies here live for everyone to see.
So what I want to discuss...
No, you don't tell me what you want to discuss. You don't dictate.
Yes, I will.
You won't.
Of Genesis 48.
No, you won't.
I've heard this argument several times.
No.
Genesis 48.
No, go back to Hebrews 1 like you ran from a car. You don't tell me what to do, dude. Go to Hebrews 1 when you try to misapply the Septuagint because I'm going to bury you in the Septuagint. Go to Hebrews 1.
No.
Do you want me to block Genesis you, dude? 48. You're a dog Genesis. And I'm going to muzzle you. I'm not here to respect you. You're a son of the devil. Go to Hebrews 1.
A son of the devil, and your mother's a dog.
No, your mother's a whore. That's why she gave birth to you.
Your mother's a whore.
Why don't you give me your location? Go ahead. Give it to me.
I'm in Detroit, Michigan.
Shut up, you stupid bastard.
Dog.
You're a whore. You're a whore. You stupid bastard. See? There you go. See? Hold on, guys. Sorry, guys, about that. Well, this dog, you see, he's actually a Staffordite. He's a Staffordite. He's a follower of Stafford. EEW, guys. He's on YouTube. His name is EEW. EEW. He's a Staffordite. He's the dog that I embarrassed. Hold on. Let me say this. No, you stupid whore. Give me your location. Let's see if you're going to bark in my face. You're now on YouTube. You're recorded. EEW. Be more man than your mother. You insulted my mother, but your mother's a whore. She gave birth to you. Give me your location. Stop barking. EEW, you Staffordite whore. We'll be waiting for everyone to hear. Guys, you heard it. He's recorded. Stupid bastard. Anyway, guys, let's begin. You ready? All right, now, thank the Lord. You see, the demons are manifesting. Now, with that said, coming back to the issue, he's another dog like Muhammad. They're all of the same father. All right, now, with that said, EEW, E, initials E, N-E-N-W. So, glory to Jesus Christ. See, that's how you got to be, guys. You know you're doing something right when the demons manifest and threaten you. Glory to Jesus Christ. Yeah, baby. But they're only men behind the screen. I promise you that. Now, with that said, according to Islam, Allah sent Muhammad in the name of Allah to glorify Allah. Jesus sent the Comforter in his name to glorify him. Therefore, Jesus is Allah, the God of Muhammad. Jesus is Allah, the God of Muhammad. The dog keeps calling. Should I pick up this dog's call and let him expose himself and his mother? Or should I just block him, guys? You want me to block him? Okay. You guys want me to block this dog? Okay, go ahead. All right. Dude, you keep calling my mother a whore, but you're confusing her with your mother. She gave birth to a satanic bastard like you, and there's not a damn thing you can do about it. We're destroying your satanic god and burying you, you little slut. If you're a man, give me your location and then do what you can do. Keep barking, little whore, as we destroy your god. Thank you. So now we got it. Thank you, guys. Anyway, glory to Jesus Christ. He just called my mother a whore again. Oh, I'm a loose sleep. Wait. The fact is, my mother's not a whore. My mother's in the presence of Jesus Christ. His mother is a whore because a dog gave birth to him. A spiritual dog gave birth to him, and he thinks he's human. Now, with that said, if Muhammad is the Comforter, Jesus is Allah. But now we got more problems. Are you ready? We got more problems for the Muslims. The Quran says Allah is not the father and Jesus is not his son. The Quran says Allah is not the father and Jesus is not his son. Okay, now here you got to hear this argument, guys, because the demon, you know we're doing something right. You know the Lord Jesus being glorified and the body's being edified when I get this viciously attacked by all different sons of Satan. Notice this guy is an Aryan, but notice his hatred and vitriol is the same like Muslims, because their father is the same. They're all spiritual whores born of the same spiritual whore, right? Now, the Quran says Allah is not the father and Jesus is not the son. Allah is not the father and Jesus is not the son. But wait, guys, pay attention to this. Muhammad is the comforter, and he surely knew that it was the Father and Jesus the Son that sent him in the name of Jesus to glorify Jesus. Therefore, the Quran would never contradict what Muhammad the Comforter would have been preaching. He would have been preaching, look, the Allah in whose name I preach and whom I glorify is Jesus along with his Father. The Father and Jesus together are Allah, because I'm the Comforter sent by the Father and Jesus, his Son, in the name of Jesus, by the authority of Jesus, to glorify Jesus. So my Allah is the Father and Son. Therefore, this proves that the Muslims corrupted the original message. The original message of Muhammad taught Muslims say there is no Allah except the Father and the Son, and that Jesus is Allah who sent me, whom I glorified, my Lord and my Savior. The Muslims didn't like that, so they twisted the Quran, butchered the Quran, perverted the Quran, and removed all references from Muhammad that Allah is the Father and the Son, and that Jesus is the Allah whom Muhammad worships and glorifies. You got it? You see that? You see how I just turned it against them? Do you see what I just did, right? So agree with them. They're blasphemy that the comforter is Muhammad. Okay. Who sent the comforter? Jesus did. Who else? The Father with Jesus. In whose name? By whose authority? Jesus' authority. To glorify who? Jesus. And the comfort came out of where? From the Father. And the comforter is Muhammad? Yes. Thank you for proving to me that Allah is the Father and Jesus' Son. The Almighty Allah is Father and Son. Binitarianism. You see how easy that was to destroy the argument? So you see how easy that was to destroy the argument? Now, if you learned that argument, you see now why to even say this is Muhammad is blasphemy. And it's a waste of time. But now that you destroyed that argument, let me respond to his objection. He said it can't be the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit was already there. But according to John 16:7, the Comforter wasn't there. Now, are you ready for me to respond to this? Now, let's explain why we Christians need to know our Bibles. And we Christians need to know context, and we Christians need to be trained by the Spirit to read verses in the context that we find them. Context can mean read the verses before and after, or read the chapters before and after, or read all the writings of that author in context to more accurately understand a verse. Let me repeat what context means. The context means either I read that verse or verses in light of the chapter, what came before and after, or in light of the chapters that came before and after, or in light of the book as a whole, or in light of all the writings of that author, to see what that author has to say about a particular subject in context. In the context of the chapter, in the context of the book, in the context of all that he's written and stated about a particular point. You understand? Here, kitty. Kitty needs attention. Let me close the door. You understand what I mean by context? Because now you're going to understand why Jesus said that he has to go for the comforter to come. Why Jesus said he has to go for the comforter to come. Okay? You're going to see now. John 14, 16 to 17. And I will pray the Father. Again, the Father. So Allah is the Father and Jesus, his Son, together. and he shall give you another comforter, that he may abide with you forever. Now watch here. Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him. But hold on. At the time of Muhammad, there are many people in the world that saw him. But the Spirit of truth cannot be seen by the world, because he's invisible by nature. And the only way you can see him, if he chooses to appear visibly. The world cannot receive him, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him. But now here's the part that's going to now help you understand what our Lord meant, if you just know context. Here it is, John 14, 17. But you know him, for he dwelleth with you and shall be in you. Let me repeat it two more times. You, my disciples, Peter, James, and John, know him. Well, how do you know him? For he dwelleth with you. He's already here. He's here and shall be in you. Wait, wait, wait. One more time. Let it sink in by the power of the Holy Spirit. But you know him. Peter, you know him. John, you know him. James, you know him. Thomas, you know him. How do we know him, Lord? He dwelleth with you. He's here with you. And then shall be in you. So wait, Muhammad was there 600 years before he was born. So now Muslims prove Muhammad is a pre-existent spirit that came from heaven and was already there invisibly with the disciples and became flesh in the 7th century. You caught it? You caught it? You know him. He dwells with you and will be in you. He's with you already, but then he will indwell you to empower you to do ministry. So according to them, Muhammad was there with Peter, James, and John. They already knew Muhammad, but they knew him as an invisible spirit. And then later on, Muhammad became flesh. So Muslims end up affirming the pre-human existence of Muhammad as a spirit who comes out of heaven and was already there invisibly as a spirit with Peter, James, and John. You got it now? Making sense? So, now, for those of you who want to really understand what our Lord is saying, here's what he's saying. The Holy Spirit is present here now with you. The Comforter is present here now with you. The Spirit of Truth is present here now with you, because the Comforter is the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of Truth. But when I go, he won't simply be with you, because he's with me, working with me and unit with me, but he'll now work in and through you. That's what Jesus is saying. Jesus is saying, as long as I remain here, the Spirit will be working in union with me alone. But when I leave, he will then start working in and through you, empowering you, working in union with you, as he's been working in union with me. But as long as I remain, he won't be in you, working through you, because he's with me, working through me. And you know he's with me because of the miracles that the Comforter, who's the Spirit of Truth, the Holy Spirit, is doing in union with me and the Father. Now let me prove that to you from John. John 1, 32 to 33. John 1, 32 to 33. Okay. And 7, 38 to 39. John 1, 32 to 33. John 7, 38 to 39. Here you go. King James, which be not loved. John 1, 32, 33. And John bear record saying, I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove and abode upon him. And I knew him not. Right? But he that sent me to baptize with water, the same said unto me, upon whom thou shalt see the Spirit descending and remaining on him. That's the key. when the Holy Spirit appeared visibly to John in the shape of a dove, that visible sign was the proof that John needed to know that's the Messiah, the Son of God. But not only did he come down on him, it remained on him. The same as he which baptizeth with the Holy Ghost. Now notice what John 7, 38 to 39 states. John 7, 38 to 39 states, okay? He that believeth on me, as the scripture hath said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. So if you believe in him, you'll have rivers of living water. But this spake he of the Spirit. So Jesus saying, if you believe in me, you'll have the Holy Spirit indwelling you, preserving you for everlasting life. Because he is the living waters that refreshes you, quenches your thirst, cleanses you, and keeps you alive in union with the Father and the Son. Which they that believe on him should receive. So when you believe on him, you will receive. But at that time, when Jesus on earth, they didn't receive him. Why? For the Holy Ghost was not yet given. As long as Jesus is on earth, the Holy Spirit wasn't given to anyone to indwell and preserve and work through. Because the Holy Spirit was now working through Jesus to bring people to Jesus. Because that Jesus was not yet glorified. So notice, when would the Holy Spirit be given to Peter, James, and John? After Christ died, was raised, subsequent to his resurrection and on his way to heavenly glory. Up until that point, the Spirit was with him, working through him, bringing people to him. But then later, it would indwell believers and preserve believers and teach believers and transform believers. Does it make sense now? Does it make sense now? Are you getting it? You see why Jesus says, it's for your sake I leave. Because when I leave, the Holy Spirit, whom you know already, who's with you already, John 14, 17, you know him because he dwells with you. Then when I leave, he'll be in you. Because as long as I'm here, the Spirit remains on me in all his fullness, works through me to convict people and convince them of who I am. But he won't be operating in and through you. He's operating in and through me to draw you to me. But then when I leave, then the Spirit comes, will operate in and through you. Okay? You see why I keep hammering to all of you. Context. Read context. Learn context. And all these objections are destroyed by context. But we Christians don't learn to read in context. So what is our Lord saying? Our Lord is saying, when I leave, the Holy Spirit will come and teach you all things. And he'll reveal things to you that you cannot handle now because spiritually you're not mature enough. You're not where you need to be spiritually to understand these things. Here, let me show it to you. Let me show you our Lord saying this. John 14, 26, 16, 12 to 13. John 14, 26, 16, 12 to 13. John 14, 26. But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things and bring all things to remembrance whatsoever I've said unto you. So the Holy Spirit's going to do two things among many. Two things among many. One, he's going to remind the disciples of all Jesus said so they don't forget. Two, he's then going to teach them everything else they need to know for salvation, for holiness, for sanctification, in order to know how to delight the Lord and remain in union with Christ for everlasting life. You caught it? You caught it? So he's saying, the words I spoken to you, you don't fully comprehend. They're beyond your ability. However, not to worry, because when the Holy Spirit comes, he'll remind you of what I said and enable you to understand. And then he's going to reveal everything else that you're not ready for now until he comes. Because that's John 16, 12 to 13. John 16, 12 to 13. Here it is. I have yet many things to say unto you. John 16, 12 to 13. But ye cannot bear them now. You can't handle the things I want to make known to you. Howbeit, however, when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you into all truth. See, that's his role. For he shall not speak of himself. He won't speak on his own initiative. Whatsoever he shall hear, whatever he hears from the Father and me, whatever the Father and I want you to know, he'll make it known to you. Because he's going to reveal to you what the Father and I want you to know, but you cannot handle them now, because you're going to need the Holy Spirit to then empower you and elevate you to that level where you can understand them. And he will show you things to come. Not only will he make things known to you that I taught while on earth that you can't comprehend, remind you of those things and enable you to now understand them, but he will also reveal other things and future things, so that now when he comes, you're ready and enabled and empowered by him to understand those things and then pass them on for future generations. Do you see how important the Holy Spirit is? Why do you think I emphasize in my sessions, like a broken record, ask the Holy Spirit, pray to the Holy Spirit to enable you, empower you, illuminate you, enlighten you and me, because that's his role. Jesus cannot lie. He's the truth. And he swore he will send the Spirit, and it's the role of the Spirit to teach you, to guide you, to perfect you, and enable you and elevate you to a level of spiritual maturity where all of this makes sense, and then give you the power to then act upon it and live it out for the glory of Jesus. That's his role. That's what Jesus has sent to the church. Why do you think in my prayers I praise and I thank the Father and the Son for the gift of the Holy Spirit? Because I know the Bible is true. I know the words of Jesus in the Bible are true. And I know that his promise was to send the Spirit to remain with us forever, to guide the church forever until the Lord returns. And when he returns, it will still be the Spirit to preserve us perfectly for Christ forever. Exactly, Crimson. Any movement that says the church was lost in the second century means that Jesus lied and the Holy Spirit is a failure, which is blasphemy. Because Jesus said, when the Spirit comes, I'll slap. When the Spirit comes, he'll guide you into all truth. And because he's almighty, he cannot fail and hasn't failed and will not fail until Jesus comes. And when Jesus comes, he'll continue to successfully, without failure, preserve us for Jesus forever. Because he's almighty and cannot fail. You get my point? I wanted to sink in. You see why I got attacked by demons today? Blasphemous, filthy swine who think they're men behind the camera to threaten me. And they think I'm going to back down because I'm afraid. And you see why you can't be effeminate. You got to be bold. Or they're going to try to eat you up for their satanic god, these dogs whom Jesus is delivering through our hands to silence, like EEW. And you heard it, right? We got to record it. Who came on insulting my mother first? He did. It's recorded. So I treat a fool according to his folly and give him a taste of his own medicine. Because I'm not talking about the human mother that gave birth to him, because no human gave birth to this dog. It was a filthy animal, a dog that gave birth to a bastard like him. Keep barking and we're destroying your satanic god, EEW, and there's not a damn thing you can do about it. Glory to Jesus Christ. Right? That's why you got to pray hard for me. Pray God will miraculously protect me and preserve me, even though he doesn't need me, and miraculously protect and preserve my daughters and make me bold and more spirit-filled and more holy and more obedient and more in love with Jesus till I die and never back down. Never. To be like the holy apostles and the prophets and the early church fathers. In Jesus' name. You with me there? Everyone got it? Did it make sense how important the Holy Spirit is? That's one of the reasons why, my Protestant brothers and sisters, I changed my position on these doctrines. Let me explain. What do I mean? If we believe the Bible, and these are the words of the circle Jesus, and we believe his promise that the Holy Spirit has come, and the Holy Spirit who's almighty, he's God almighty, and will perfectly preserve and guide the church into all truth and enable the church to understand the truth of Scripture, then you have a problem in your hands, Protestants. What do I mean? It is a fact of history that the church before the schism, before the split in the 400s, universally, no internet, no email, wherever you found the church, they all agreed on the following. This is a fact, guys. Perpetual virginity of Mary, water baptismal regeneration, the Eucharist as the flesh and blood of Christ, an office of priesthood that became widespread and accepted early on. They accepted all these things, which means these things must be true, must be in accord with Scripture, because there's no way the Holy Spirit would allow the majority of Christians or the unified body of believers universally to all agree and teach error and heresy. Otherwise, you're going to say the Holy Spirit failed, and that's blasphemy. And you're going to be a restorationist like the Campbellites, the Millerites, the Seventh-day Adventists, and Jehovah's Witnesses, because that's what they say, that in the second century, the church became apostate, and the church was, for all intents and purposes, lost until the Holy Spirit restored it in the 1800s. That's why I changed. I didn't change because I was going to be popular and make more money. Actually, it's the reverse. Because I know the Bible is true, Jesus is Lord, and he cannot lie, and the Holy Spirit has come, and the Holy Spirit will not allow the unified church, the universal church, or the majority of Christian scholars, theologians, to agree on falsehood, on error, especially damnable heresy. So then explain to me, James White, which you never do and you run from, the universal acceptance of the priesthood, the Eucharist as the flesh and blood of Christ, water baptismal regeneration, infant baptism, perpetual virginity of Mary, the communion of saints, widespread accepted across the board. I want to repeat what this brother said. Steadfast Godcast. Thank you so much for opening my eyes, Sam. It was like a sledgehammer to the sides of my head. God bless you. That's not me. Thank the Holy Spirit, because it's the Holy Spirit who gives illumination and uses human vessels to do so. So pray the Holy Spirit will preserve me, embolden me to be a lion who's willing to be killed for Jesus and not back down. You better believe it, Warren. If it's not, that means, Warren, the Holy Spirit allowed the universal church early on from embracing this doctrine that's contrary to Scripture. Yes, Warren. In fact, Warren, even Martin Luther believed in infant baptism and water baptismal regeneration, which is why Lutherans uphold it, and Episcopalians. And John Calvin believed in infant water baptism, but did not believe it regenerated. And he would be a novelty, because up until the Reformers, that's what the church believed universally. You got it now? So you understand what the Paraclete passages are. In a nutshell, the Paraclete passages are Jesus promising to send the Holy Spirit to continue the work Jesus did on earth. What he's saying is, in my physical absence, when I leave you physically, the Spirit will come and bring my presence to you, and the Father's presence to you, so the Spirit will give you access to my divine presence and the Father's divine presence. So though I'm not with you physically, I'm with you in union with the Holy Spirit to now empower you and move you to continue the work I began until I return. That's what the Paraclete passages are all about. So if someone asks you, what is this promise of the Paraclete, the Comforter, all about? Let me repeat. The promise is this. Physically, I cannot remain with you until I return at the end of the age. However, just because physically I won't be with you, don't despair, because I will still remain with you by the Holy Spirit, who will mediate, bring my divine presence, the Father's divine presence, to you, so that we will be with you by the Spirit, empowering you by the Spirit, and moving you by the Spirit to continue the work I began on earth while I was with you in the flesh. Because in the flesh, I won't be with you. Because in the flesh, I'll be in heaven. And you'll have my flesh mediated to you at the Eucharist. But besides that, though I won't be physically with you, I am still with you in virtue of my divine presence. The presence of God, his divine presence, which cannot be seen, which is not physical or material, tangible, nonetheless is more real than something material and tangible. That presence is with us till Jesus returns, because the Spirit brings God's presence, the Father's presence, the Son's presence to us. You get it? It's because of sola scriptura, Loris, that I ended up changing my position. You're still not getting it. Gottfried, what is my take on me blocking you and asking me a question that's not relevant to the topic? What is my take on me blocking you for asking a question that has nothing to do with the session? Everyone got that now? Do you understand now? Did you understand your theology? If someone asks you, what is this prophecy of the Paraclete all about? Do we get it now? Is that clear? Crimson, don't start a debate on sola scriptura. Don't fall for that snare of the devil. Please, guys. This is Satan's way of trying to distract you. Did I confuse anyone? But still, I got 40 minutes to talk. I still got 40 more minutes. But I'm repeating myself more than once, because we're creature repetition. We need to hear something repetitively until it sinks in. Everyone got it? Neil, if your parents are Catholic, then they baptized you in the Catholic Church. And that's part of the Catholic faith. Infant baptism. It's part of the tradition of the Orthodox and the Church of the East and the Coptic Church, as well as the Lutherans. So I don't understand what you're asking me. Okay, now, if that's clear, now let's end Ahmad Didat's decimation. He's already been buried, but now we're going to cremate him and spread his ashes over Mecca. Over Mecca, because now what we're going to do is read what Jesus says about himself and the Father in the very context of these verses that they ignore. Okay, watch this. John 14, verses 1 to 6. Same chapter where Jesus mentions the promise of the Paraclete for the first time. Let's read. We're going to read King James Bible, which is Didat's preferred version. Was. He's dead now. Okay, now watch. Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. Did Didat believe God was his Father? No. Did the Quran teach that Allah of Muhammad is a spiritual father to Muhammad and Muslims? No. Then why are you quoting a chapter where God is Jesus's Father and the Father of all who believe in Jesus, which the Quran denies? And this is a spiritual filial fatherhood, not physical, not sexual, which we condemn as well. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. And whither I go, you know, and the way, you know. Now, notice the second promise. Jesus says, I'm preparing a mansion for all who believe in me. And the time will come where I will come for you and take you to be with me, with my Father, so you can dwell in this mansion. Now, people ask me, when does this happen? Let me answer the question. I need you to pay attention. People ask me, when does Jesus come to take us into our mansion? When you're going to die. This is referring to Jesus's promise for those who at their physical death die in friendship and union with Christ. How do I know that? Because at the second coming, Jesus doesn't take you to dwell with him in heaven. At the second coming, Jesus comes to live on earth in his glorified physical body of flesh. So the only time Jesus can fulfill this promise of taking you to be with him where he is, where he's in heavenly glory, is at your death. Because that's when your spirit leaves and Jesus takes you into heaven to behold his heavenly glory and to behold the Father in the Father's visible glory and others who've died before you to fellowship with angels, where then he clothes you in a white robe and tells you to wait until then he brings your spirit with him when he returns physically to the earth and resurrects your body physically. You get it there? Now, which Muslim believes that Jesus comes for believers when they die to take their spirits and souls to be with him, beholding him in his heavenly glory, where they see his glorified physical body that's made immortal and deathless, as a sign of what our bodies will be like when he raises our bodies out of the tombs? So we also behold the Father's visible glory, where the Father appears visibly on a throne, like John saw him in Revelation 4 and 5, when he was taken into heaven by the Spirit and saw the Father in visible shape, visibly seated on a visible throne. Which Muslim believes that? Nobody does. Now, Thomas, who wasn't getting it, asks a question. John 14, 5 to 6. Thomas saith unto him, Lord, we know not whether thou goest. How can we know the way? We have no idea where you're going. So how are we going to know the way there? Now notice the words of Jesus. Jesus saith unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. Okay. According to the Quran and Sunnah, the tradition of Muhammad, the truth is one of the names of Allah. One of the 99 names of Allah is Al-Haq. And the life is something only true of Allah in Islam. Allah is the life giver. Allah is the truth. And I'll give you just one passage of the Quran to prove it. We won't look at it, but chapter 22 of the Quran, verses 6 and 7, it says, Allah, he's the truth, and he gives life to the dead. And the hour is coming, have no doubt, where Allah will give life to those out of the graves. Jesus says, I am the truth, I am the life. The very things that Islam says can only be said of God. Why did Ahmad Didat ignore this? Why did Ahmad Didat ignore that in very chapter where he speaks of the Comforter, Jesus says, I am the truth, a name that Islam says is true only of God. I am the life, meaning I'm the one who gives life. Something Islam says is true only of God. And I prepare a mansion, and at your death, I will come to take you to be with me, with my Father, where we're at. How does this agree with Islam? And why are we Christians allowing them to get away with murder? This is our book. Let's learn to interpret our book, understand our book, live in obedience to our book, proclaim it, and not allow people to use our book, God's word, the sword of the Spirit given to us, use it against us. But it's going to get worse for Didat. John 14, 12 to 14. John 14, 12 to 14. Good time. We got half an hour more. Thank you, Lord Jesus. And then we're going to go listen to Chris Claus debate Taylor Stewart. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me, the works that I do shall he do also. And greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto my Father. Okay. Does Didat believe that Jesus's Father is his Father, Muhammad's Father, Allah of the Quran? Absolutely not. Chapter 5, verse 18 of the Quran is clear. Allah is not a spiritual father. He doesn't have spiritual children. That's why Jews and Christians are not his spiritual children. And chapter 9, verse 30, we're told Jesus is not the son of Allah. Chapter 9, verse 30. And in chapter 19, verses 88 to 93, chapter 19, verses 88 to 93, the only relationship you can have with Muhammad's God is a slave to master. We are his slaves. He's the master. But Jesus says, I'm going to my father. But now notice what he says will happen when he goes to the father. You will be doing the same miracles I've been doing. That's where the comforter comes. See, the comforter is with me. So I, with the comforter, who's the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of truth, with the Father, all of us together, we are doing the miracles that you are seeing. Now, let me repeat what I just said. The comforter, who's the Spirit of truth, who's the Holy Spirit, is there with Jesus. That's why he tells the disciples, he's already with you, but then we'll be in you. And you know he's with you because the miracles I do in union with him. But it wasn't just Jesus and the Spirit doing the miracles. It was also the Father. So according to Jesus in John 14, the Father was there, the Holy Spirit was there, working with Jesus, in Jesus, through Jesus, even though Jesus is the only one who became flesh. The Father didn't become man. The Spirit didn't become man. They didn't become flesh. They didn't take on human nature. Jesus alone did. But when he became man and took on human nature and a physical body, Father and Spirit used Jesus's physical body, worked in that body, worked through that body in union with Jesus to do the miracles. Let me prove it to you. John 14, 9 to 11. The whole Trinity was there. Jesus saith unto him, have I been, John 14, 9 to 11, have I been so long time with you, and yet hast thou not known me, Philip? He that hath seen me hath seen the Father. How sayest thou then, show us the Father? Believest thou not that I am in the Father and the Father in me? Now notice what he didn't say. Believest thou not that I am the Father and the Father is me? No. He's in me, I'm in him. I'm not the Father, but the Father is with me. Believest thou not that I am in the Father and Father in me? The words that I speak unto you, I speak not of myself, but the Father that dwelleth in me. So the Holy Spirit dwells in me. The Holy Spirit is with me. The Father dwells in me. The Father, they're all together on earth. But the Father that dwelleth in me, he doeth the works. Believe me that I am in the Father and the Father in me, or else believe me for the very work's sake. The miracles I do is proving to you my Father is with you. The Holy Spirit is with you because they're with me, working with me, and all of us together are doing the miracles, even though I'm the only one. I'm the only one who became flesh. I'm the only one who became man. I'm the only one who took on a human nature. So I have two natures, one person, Father, didn't become a man, Spirit didn't become flesh, but they're still with me, working in me, working through me. We're working together always. So the miracles are the Father's. The miracles are mine, and the miracles are the Holy Spirit, because the miracles are done by all three of us. You're getting it? Holy Spirit, grant my throat perfect health, and strengthen my voice not to give in. You get it? But now let's continue. Okay. Believe for the sake of the works. Now, notice what Jesus says. So the works I've been doing with the Father and the Spirit, he says, you too, you believe me, shall do these works. But greater number of them, same quality, same kind of miracles, but a greater number because you're going to reach more people, right? And go to more places than I've been doing so on earth. But now here's the reason why. Greater works than these shall he do because I go to the Father, my Father. Now, how does Jesus going to the Father result in the disciples doing a greater number of miracles than Jesus did? Here's the answer. Whatsoever ye shall ask in my name, that will I do. John 14, 13 and 14. Whatsoever ye shall ask in my name, that will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If ye shall ask anything in my name, I will do it. That's the answer. When I go to my Father, You will ask in my name, and I from heaven with the Father and the Spirit, I myself in heaven will do the miracles for you, will give you the power to do the miracles. I will empower you from heaven. So you on earth with my power, which is the Father's power and the Spirit's power, will do the miracles. Why didn't D-Dot quote that? Exactly, Michael Solomon. Does D-Dot believe that Jesus is in heaven with his Father answering prayers on earth? D-Dot believe, which is the same chapter, because right after that, Jesus mentions the Comforter, the Spirit of Truth, Holy Spirit. Same chapter, Jesus says, when I'm with my Father, I will give you the power on earth to do the miracles because I'll be doing it for you. The Spirit will be doing it for you. The Father, all three of us will be doing it for you like all three of us were doing it while I was on earth. Why didn't he quote that? And why do we Christians let them get away with not quoting the entire section? Everyone with me there? I got more. I'm not finishing it yet. You with me so far? How about this one? Same chapter, John 14, where our Lord mentions the Comforter, Holy Spirit. What about John 14, 23? How about this one? Jesus answered and said unto him, if a man love me, he will keep my words, and my Father will love him. So if you keep my words, that's how you prove to yourself you love me. May the Holy Spirit give us power to obey Jesus' words, to prove to ourselves, the hell with what people think, to prove to ourselves we love the Lord. So if we truly love the Lord and prove it by obeying him, here's the promise. My Father will love him, and we, Father and I together, will come unto him and make our abode with him. Not only does the Holy Spirit dwell with you and shall be in you, but Jesus swore, I with the Father in unity with the Spirit will live for you, will live with you, not for you. Lord, save me from error. We live for him. He doesn't live for us, but he is for us. He loves us. We'll live with you. We'll dwell with you and fellowship with you and oversee and protect you. Who? Spirit with the Father and the Son. And this promise is for who? Those who obey him. That means Jesus just claimed to be just as present, truly present, with all believers, no matter how many they are, no matter where they at, to the same degree, to the same extent that the Father is present with us. No creature can claim to have the ability that the Father does to dwell with every believer, no matter how many, no matter where they're at, in order to have fellowship, communion, and love with every believer. So this shows that Jesus thinks he's omnipresent, omniscient, and omnipotent. That's the same chapter that did not quote it to show Muhammad is the paraclete. Are you serious? Are you serious? And I forgot this glorious promise. You who are mourning, look at the promise of our Lord. John 14, 18 to 19. Carolyn, everyone, listen. Jesus in John 14, 18, 19. I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you. And he did return to them physically, to disciples, to comfort them. And then he left physically. But that promise is still ours in that he does come to us by the Spirit, bringing Christ's presence to us truly and really. Yet a little while, the world seeth me no more. But you see me. And notice his promise. Carolyn, everyone, because I live, ye shall live also. Now, why is that a promise that made Carolyn shout hallelujah? Because Carolyn's beloved husband is with the Lord Jesus. When her husband died, that's when Jesus came to him and told her husband, come, I will now take you to be with me and my Father in glory and to situate you in your mansion. And that's why the Lord then came to Carolyn and did not leave her comfortless, but comforted her, knowing her husband was taken by the Lord to dwell in his mansion, where he sees Jesus in his glorified physical body and sees the Father in visible glory waiting for Carolyn to join him. And all of us who have loved ones with the Lord in their mansions waiting for us. Right? right? All right. Now, what about John 16? We're almost done, guys. We're going to wrap it up in a minute. John 16. And I, for the most part, I'm done. There's nothing more to refute. That's it. There is no Muhammad in the New Testament where he's said to be a true prophet. Muhammad is in the New Testament in that he's said to be an antichrist. An antichrist, the son of the devil, is burning in hell. That I'll show you. Now, remember John 16, 7? The dot said Jesus had to go for the comfort to come. Well, hold on. Why didn't the dot emphasize these verses? Watch these verses. John 16, 14 and 15. He shall glorify me, for he shall receive of mine and shall show it unto you. Why didn't he quote verse 15? All things that the Father hath are mine. Whatever the Father owns belongs to Jesus the Son. All things that the Father hath are mine. Therefore said I that he shall take of mine and shall show it unto you. Okay. Dost thee not believe? Did he believe? Because he's dead now and he didn't repent. He's burning in hell with Muhammad. Do any Muslims believe that Jesus is the Son who owns everything that the Father possesses? All that the Father has are mine. Okay, do they believe that? Well, hold on. Doesn't God the Father own everything in creation? The entire creation belongs to the Father. Every created thing belongs to the Father. All human beings belong to the Father. Yes. Well, Jesus says, everything that the Father has is mine. So Jesus just claimed that he owns the entire creation. He owns all the heavens, all the earth, everything in them, every creature, which means Jesus just said he owns Muhammad. He owns Ahmadidat. He owns Muslims. He owns all of you and all that you possess, which means Jesus owns Muhammad and Muhammad is under the feet of Jesus. Do you believe that? The same chapter, which you didn't quote? Why didn't you quote this, Didot? John 16, 25 to 31. Watch this, guys. John 16, 25 to 31. Why didn't he quote this? Why didn't he quote this? These things have I spoken to you, the same chapter in Proverbs. I spoke to you in parables. But the time cometh, the time's coming, when I shall no more speak unto you in Proverbs. I won't speak in parables, but I shall show you, reveal to you plainly, clear language of the Father. At that day you shall ask in my name, by my authority. And I say not unto you that I will pray the Father for you. I won't need to ask the Father for you. Why? For the Father himself loveth you. Why does the Father love them, Jesus? Because you have loved me. Because you love me, my Father loves you. And have believed that I came out from God. Oh, boy. Wait. So Jesus isn't merely human of the earth. He came out of the Father like the Comforter came out of the Father, proceeded from the Father, out of heaven. Watch here, 28 to 29. I came forth from the Father and have come into the world. Again, I leave the world and go to the Father. Which Muslims believe that Jesus was there with the Father, that God the Father is the Father, and Jesus was there with the Father before he was born of the Virgin and came out of the Father down from heaven to enter Mary to become flesh, and now is there with the Father, not Allah, but the Father, and Allah is not the Father. Which Muslim believes that? And that Jesus is not speaking allegorically, metaphorically, but literally? Here it is. John 16, 29 to 31. The disciples said unto him, lo, now speakest thou plainly. See, you're speaking plainly. So the Muslims can't say it's allegorical, metaphorical, and do ta'wil. No, you're speaking plainly. Plain speech, and speakest no proverb. You're not speaking in a parable. You're speaking actually plainly. You actually came from the Father into the world, and you will actually leave the world and go to the Father, but this time as flesh. Now are we sure? Now we have no doubt. We are sure that thou knowest all things. Now we have no doubt. You know everything. You're omniscient. Uh-oh. And needest not that any man should ask thee. We now know you know everything. We don't need to test your knowledge to see if you know what you're talking about. You know all things. You're omniscient. Uh-oh. By this we now believe and know, we believe that thou camest forth from God. Wait. You mean when Jesus spoke plainly, when Jesus spoke clearly, not parabolically, allegorically, they realized now that you're speaking plainly, clearly, not parabolically, now we know you know everything and you came out of the Father from heaven into the world. But I thought Jesus is Muslim. I thought the disciples were Muslim. How does this comport with the Islamic Isa and the Islamic Allah? Now, wait, Jesus rebuked them. Remember, Jesus is a good Muslim. He would have rebuked them. Shut up. Astaghfirullah. A'udhu billah. Min Muhammad rajim. Takbir. Shut up. Don't say that. Kafir. Look what he says here. John 16:31. Jesus answered them, do you now believe? You finally got it? You finally understood? And you finally now believe? It took you a while. You believe now finally? What took you so long? Do you see how this just annihilated, destroyed, obliterated Muhammad, Islam, the Quran, all of the Quran and D-dot? Complete, utter annihilation. It's over, guys. It's done with. Done. It's done. So now you learn more about the irrefutable proof for the Trinity. The true God of the Bible, and the Bible is his living word, is triune, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Now you learn a little more about the role of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit continues in us and through us the work that Jesus began while he was on earth physically. And the Holy Spirit will enable you and grace you and empower you to reach a level of spiritual maturity. Now you understand the words of Christ and they're not difficult to comprehend. That's his work in you out of his love for you. And he will abide with you and preserve you until Jesus comes. And when Jesus comes, he'll continue to preserve you forever in union with Christ perfectly and inseparably. You learn that, right? You're learning all this from Scripture. And then you learn that Jesus has sworn and cannot lie. He is preparing mansions for every believer so that when you are ready to die, he will come to you either directly or send an angel or a loved one, and they will usher in your spirit, your soul, when it leaves your body. And Jesus takes you to your mansion and says, here, this is your home until I return. Because all of you will return with me when I descend physically to reign on earth forever, when then I will resurrect your physical bodies and make them morally incorruptible and immortal, so you'll dwell in physical bodies like mine, and we'll all live on earth forever. But until then, I'm bringing you to be with me and my Father. Well, you'll see my Father in heavenly glory, visibly on a throne with angels and other believers. And that's Hebrews 12:22-24. Hebrews 12:22-24 says, in heavenly Jerusalem are myriads of angels. In heavenly Jerusalem, you'll find the church of the firstborn, where they're having church and worship service there. In heavenly Jerusalem, you'll see God the Father, the judge of all. In heavenly Jerusalem, you'll see the spirits of those who died before you, believers who died in Christ, who are there as spirits who are now perfected, sinless and immortal, pain-free, disease-free, deathless, sin-free. And it says, there you'll find Jesus and the blood that he presents to the Father to atone for us. They're all there right now until Jesus returns. Okay? So you see how much you learn about your own faith. You learn about the interpretation of these promises of the Paraclete. So it's not so much about destroying these heretics. It's learning your faith, learning theology, learning context. Because once you do, then the outflow of that is refuting heretics easily because you know your Bible. And now we need to live it out. Let's live out the Bible, obey the Bible, proclaim the Bible to prove to Jesus we love him. Clear? Okay, now let's finish the last point he made about the Bible calling prophets, spirits. Let's destroy this line. We're done.
The Bible says, you see, every time the word spirit is used in your Bible, I'm telling the Christian, it doesn't stand for the Holy Ghost. Because in the book of Revelation, the last book of the Bible, we are told that seven spirits of God went out into the world. I see you believe in seven Holy Ghosts.
Now notice what an idiot is. In the book of Revelation, I did a session on this. The word, the number seven, is symbolic for completion and perfection. Seven means completion. How do we know? Because after God created the heavens and the earth and everything in them in 6 days, he saw creation is very good. Genesis 1:31. Therefore, in Genesis 2, verses 1 to 3, it says, God finished his work. Finished. Completed. And therefore, sanctified the seventh day, blessed it, and entered his rest on the seventh day, calling it the Sabbath, because he finished, completed his work. So seven represents something is complete. You're finished. It's complete. Well, if it's complete, it lacks nothing. It's perfect. And this is further confirmed in Revelation 15, verse 1. In Revelation 15, verse 1, it says that God sent seven angels with the seven last plagues to pour out on the earth, because through those seven plagues, his judgment is complete. Okay, pay attention. Revelation 15, verse 1. It takes only seven plagues to complete God's judgment, his total perfect judgment on evildoers. So notice, seven plagues equals perfect judgment, complete judgment. So the judgment is complete. It is finished. It is perfect. Seven plagues. Notice seven again. So why seven spirits? That's because the Holy Spirit is appearing in visible shape, in visible form, as seven spirits, as seven eyes, as seven lampstands, to denote that the Holy Spirit of God is completely perfect in everything he does. He provides perfect illumination, because a lampstand is used to see. So he grants you perfect insight, illumination. And seven eyes also means that he sees everything perfectly. He has perfect sight. He sees and oversees everything perfectly, because his awareness of everything is perfect. So seven spirits means the Holy Spirit is perfect, lacks nothing in everything he does. That's why seven. You got it? But an idiot like him, I don't expect him to know that. Let's continue.
He says, no, there's only one Holy Ghost. I said, it's seven spirits. It means should be seven Holy Ghosts. No, spirit doesn't stand for Holy Ghost every time. Then in the same John.
Now watch here. Look at his liar. 5,
verse 4. He says, believe not every spirit, but try the spirits whether they are of God. For many false prophets have gone out into the world. False prophet is a false spirit. True prophet is a true spirit.
Nope.
St. John is using spirit for a prophet.
I'm going to refute it right now.
Don't believe every spirit. Don't believe in every prophet. The spirit, it says, that confesseth that Jesus is the Christ is of God.
Now listen to this.
There's a prophet that says that Jesus is the Christ, is the Messiah. The Messiah is from Allah. That's what John says. I said, we'll find out whether this spirit, this prophet, Muhammad, let's say that Jesus is the Christ.
Oh.
Open Surah Ali Imran, chapter 3, verse 45. It says, إِذْ قَالَتِ الْمَلَائِكَةُ يَا مَرْيَمُ. So behold, the angel said, O Mary, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُبَشِّرُكِ بِكَلِمَةٍ.
It's almost done, guys, because down at 9 we're done. We'll be done with this and we go listen to Chris Foss debate.
His name will be the Messiah, translated Christ. Muhammad said, is he the Christ? Yes, that's what every Muslim believes. On the testification of the Holy Prophet Muhammad, 1,000 million Muslims of the world, they believe that Jesus is the Christ. He says, the spirit that confesseth, the prophet that says that Jesus is the Christ, is of God. Why don't you apply this to Muhammad? Jesus says, I have yet many things to say unto you, but you cannot bear them now. So this spirit, this Holy Ghost, it is a Holy Ghost. Every church and denomination claims it. Everybody has it. All those cults that he mentions in his books, you read them, he says, look, every cultist says he's got the spirit.
Yep,
who? The Holy Ghost.
Almost done, 30 seconds.
And they're all going in different directions. So one spirit, taking you all into opposite directions.
So if Muhammad is the comforter and he guides in all truth, then Muhammad got buried by Didat. He's saying the differences among Christians show they don't have the Holy Spirit because the Holy Spirit is one and won't confuse you. Well, if that argument is valid, that means Muhammad is a failure or he can't be the spirit of truth, because how many denominations of Muslims you have, and forget Sunni and Shia, within Sunni Islam, how many different branches where you have some branches condemning others for being heretics, like the Salafi will condemn you if you deny that Allah literally has two right hands, a shin and feet, a waist, and has at least three eyes or more, because the word for eyes in Arabic in the Quran means three or more. They say these are actual attributes of Allah, unlike anything creation, and we do not allegorize them. But then you have the Maturidis and the Ash'ari saying, no, these are metaphorical. Hands means his power. And then they come to blows and condemn each other over this, let alone the Shia and the Sunnah, Sunnis. So if we take his argument to its conclusion, he just buried Muhammad again, flushed the Quran down the toilet, because the Quran has failed to bring perfect unity among Muslims. They can't even agree on what exactly the characteristics of Allah imply. Hands, are they real hands or are they metaphors for Allah's power? And then they can't even decide who succeeded Muhammad, and they've been murdering each other for centuries. So good job, Didat, of burying Muhammad. We didn't need your help, but thank you for helping nonetheless. I'm about to refute him. Just wait. God?
No, I have yet many things to say to you. Many in English is more than one. At least you understand that English.
Okay.
I have yet many things to say to you, but you cannot do them now. How be when he, the spirit of
30 more seconds, and I'm going to wrap it up.
All truth, all is also more than one. I'm asking my Christian brethren for the past 40 years. I don't want many solutions. Give me one. That the Holy Ghost gave you in 2001.
Mocking the Holy
something
Spirit.
That Jesus Christ had not already told you in so many different words. Any church, any denomination, bring me one new thing that the Holy Ghost gave you.
Okay, that's it. Now, he appealed to 1 John, right? Guys, remember? He said, John, in his letter, 1 John said, how do you test a spirit? And a spirit means prophet. He says that in John, spirit can refer to a human prophet. Human prophets are called spirits. So I'm going to destroy both those lies. He said in 1 John 2, how do you know a spirit is a true prophet? Because to him, spirit doesn't mean spirit, ethereal. It means a human prophet. Because human prophets are called spirits, according to John. That's what he said, even though he's lying through his teeth. He goes, this is how you know a spirit is a true prophet. If he says Jesus is the Christ, and he quoted chapter 3, verse 45, guys, guess what he did not quote from the same John, same letter, epistle of John, 1 John. He quoted it. He said 1 John 4. Look what John said, 1 John 2, 22, 23. 1 John 2, 22, 23. Who is a liar but he that denieth that Jesus is the Christ? See, Muhammad is a true prophet, a true spirit, the spirit of truth, because the spirit is a human prophet. Allahu Akbar. He is the Antichrist that denieth the Father and the Son. Who's the Antichrist? Al-Dajjal. The one who says, there is no Father and no Son. God is not the Father. Jesus is not the Son. Whosoever denieth the Son, the same hath not the Father. But he that acknowledgeth the Son hath the Father also. Why didn't he quote that? Why do you think he didn't quote the same epistle of John that says an antichrist, a son of the devil, an al-Masih al-Dajjal, a false messiah, is one who says God is not the Father, Jesus is not the Son. I go to the Quran. All of Muhammad is a father to no one. He's not a spiritual father. He doesn't have spiritual children like Jews and Christians believe, because to us it is blasphemy and from hell to say that God has sex, because he's not a physical being. He doesn't have sex physically. His children are spiritual, planted by spiritual seed, born of his Holy Spirit. But Muhammad said, my God isn't a father even in that sense. He's not a spiritual father. And Jesus in chapter 9, verse 30, is not the son of Allah. According to the very epistle that this son of the devil, whom Jesus humiliated, struck down like a vegetative invalid, made him a paralyzed vegetable for his blasphemy. From 1996 to 2005, bedridden, couldn't move, couldn't speak, so that Muslims could see the fear of the Lord Jesus in silencing this blasphemous dog. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for showing how mighty you are. So that's what happened to him, right? That same epistle says Muhammad is a son of the devil and antichrist, because Muhammad said Jesus is not the son and God is not the father, which according to 1 John 2, 22-23 makes him the antichrist. You caught it? Now let's finish it off for 1 John 4. The liar told you that John says a spirit is a human prophet. So the spirit of truth means a man, a prophet who speaks truth. And what is he quoting? 1 John 4. Let's read it in context to see what John actually meant. 1 John 4, we're going to read verses 1 to 6. Beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirits whether they are of God, because many false prophets have gone into the world. See, a spirit is a prophet. No, you idiot. That's not what he's saying. Hereby know ye the spirit of God. How do you know when the spirit of God is speaking? Every spirit that confesseth that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is of God. And here, this idiot didn't know what that meant. Jesus Christ come in the flesh means incarnation. He came from one place to another to become flesh. Anyone who denies that Jesus is the Christ that came into the world to become flesh. In other words, John 1, in the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. The Word was God. The Word became flesh. So what is John saying? This is how you know someone has the Holy Spirit inspiring him. If he says Jesus is that Christ, Jesus is the Christ, Christ is Jesus, they're the same person who came into the world to become flesh, then you know that man is speaking by the Holy Spirit. And every spirit that confesseth not that Jesus is Christ is come in the flesh, that Jesus is not the Christ who became flesh, actual human, is not of God. This is the spirit of Antichrist. Whereof ye have heard that it should come, even now already is it in the world. You are of God, little children, and overcome them. You've defeated these false prophets and the spirit in them. Because greater is he that is in you, the Holy Spirit in us, than he that is in the world. They are of the world, therefore speak they of the world, and the world hears them. If you're of the world, the world's going to love you. If you're of Jesus, it's going to hate you and condemn you and try to kill you. We are of God. He that knoweth God hears us. If you're of the Spirit, you're going to hear us if we're speaking by the Spirit. He that is not of God heareth not us. If you're of the world, you belong to Satan, you're going to hate us and hate our words because we're not of you. We don't speak from the world's perspective. We don't agree with the world or condone the world. And if you love the world, you're going to hate us. Hereby know we the spirit of truth and spirit of error. John is not saying, and we're going to wrap it up. John is not saying a spirit is a human prophet. John is not saying human prophets are spirits. No, you idiot. What John was saying is every prophet is speaking by some kind of spirit, because you have evil spirits, unclean spirits, which Jesus cast out a lot of them. So did the disciples. So how do you know whether a man is inspired by an evil spirit? How do you know whether a man is possessed of an unclean spirit, prophesying by an evil spirit, that it's an evil spirit, maybe Satan himself, inspiring him and teaching him? How do you know? By the message. Someone who's inspired by Satan or a demon, an evil, unclean spirit, will be speaking contrary to the revelation of the Holy Spirit, contrary to the apostles and their followers who were spirit-filled, whom the Holy Spirit taught, guided, instructed what to say and how to say it. So if Muhammad comes and tells you Jesus is not God's son, then Muhammad is speaking by an evil spirit, perhaps Satan himself, which is exactly what Muhammad initially thought. According to Muslim sources, Muhammad thought he was possessed by a jinn, a genie, Majnun. He thought a demon possessed him and wanted to commit suicide. It wasn't until his wife and Waraka convinced him otherwise that Muhammad started doubting that he was really demon possessed. So no, a spirit is not a human prophet. That's not what John is saying. John is saying all prophets speak by some kind of spirit, but not all of them speak by the same spirit. So how do I know this prophet is speaking by the true Holy Spirit, or this prophet is speaking by another spirit, an unclean spirit, maybe a demon or the devil? By what they preach. So if they deny that the eternal word, the eternal son, entered the world and became a flesh and blood human being named Jesus, that's of the devil. That person speaking by the devil or unclean spirit. If they deny that Jesus is the Son of God and God is the Father, God is the Father, that person is speaking by the devil or an unclean spirit is influencing, inspiring him. He's not speaking by the Spirit of God. That's what it means. We're now officially done with the series Muhammad in the New Testament. You've got plenty of meat where not only did you learn how to destroy Muhammad, destroy the Quran and all of the Quran, but you learned a lot more about your Bible. You learned a lot more about the Trinity, the two natures of Christ, the divine person, Holy Spirit, the work of the Holy Spirit, salvation, sanctification, and Bible interpretation. How to properly interpret the Bible and how not to interpret it. If you're listening attentively, if you're paying attention and asking the Holy Spirit to help you understand, which means make sure you do not go and pass on anything you've seen or heard or read from me without first understanding that properly. So rewatch, re-rewatch, and reread until it becomes second nature. And you need to do your part in the battle. And you can see I'm hated because I'm not politically correct. I don't tickle ears. I will insult fools and dogs and give them a taste of their own medicine. And they hate me and would love to see me killed. But that's where you come from. You come from the Spirit to join me and pray hard for me. Pray hard for my daughters. Pray for miraculous supernatural protection for my daughters and I. Pray for miraculous spirit-filled boldness to never back down, even if they beat me, torture me, kill me. The Holy Spirit will take over my mouth, never deny Jesus, but be willing to die for the Lord Jesus. Pray for me to get healthier and stay healthy, keep the weight off, so my health won't be used against me. Pray that the Lord will keep my daughters healthy. Pray the Lord will give me the power to truly love him, obey him, and be pure and war against my own sinfulness and not succumb. So I don't dishonor the Lord, but honor the Lord even when no one's watching me. Pray my daughters will grow up to be godly women in love with Jesus. And pray the Lord will do the miracle of bringing them to me so I can raise them every day and not see them every so often. Especially when this Tuesday, my youngest daughter turns 9 and I won't be there to my broken heart. So pray if you love me and pray God continue to provide for the ministry, because I'm going to lose a lot of people because they're going to think I'm too harsh. My language is too harsh. I'm not being Christ-like. And they're going to get upset with me that I've now accepted doctrines that are apostolic and ancient that Catholics believe, Orthodox believe, Church of the East, and Coptic Christians believe, to the chagrin of many Protestants who think I'm no longer a brother in Christ. So I need the support. I need your prayers, your love, and that Christ will save me from myself and the children of Satan and strike fear and terror and shame in their hearts and minds whenever they come up to try to blaspheme the Lord, that God will give me the power to silence them and never back down, but pulverize them spiritually for the glory of Christ. And for the record, I don't go around beating people up. That's not my MO, because that's not what we're called to do. I have no right, and you have no right, to go physically beat people who don't accept the truth. But I do have every right to physically protect my life. So if you're going to threaten me and you're going to stand before my face, you give me the right to defend myself, because you're not dealing with no punk. I will pwn you for the glory of Jesus. And you better stay away from my loved ones in Jesus' name. Name of the Father and of the Son of the Holy Spirit. We love you, Abba. We love you, Lord Jesus. We love you, Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, save us from our wretchedness, our sinfulness, and not to grieve you or shame you or sin against you in our anger. strike terror and silence these filthy dogs, these spiritual whores, and give us the power to be holy and truly in love with the Lord and worshipful, and wash us in the blood of the Lamb, the Lord Jesus, our loved ones, my daughters, and feed us and nourish us. Feed and nourish our loved ones, my daughters, and give me the health I need and the health in my voice and my throat, that the last thing that I will lose is my sight and my voice, so I can keep using my eyes to read your word and my voice to proclaim your word until the Lord Jesus returns or summons us. We trust in you, Spirit. We trust in you, Son of God. We trust in you, Abba, Father. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. We love you. Maranatha. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, guys, go to Chris Kloss' channel. His debate with Taylor Stewart is about to begin. Go there and support the brother. Christ is risen, risen indeed. Take care.